planning commission study meeting. Ask everyone please silence your cell phones and electronic devices. Please be courteous while we're trying, while we're in discussion. Roll call, please.
Mr. Bell?
Here.
Mr. Culpepper?
Here.
Mr. Griffith?
Here.
Mr. Huntington?
Here.
Mr. Lightner?
Here.
Mr. People?
Here.
Ms. Dillard?
Here.
Mr. Chairman, you do have a quorum to conduct business.
Okay, thank you. Okay, we're going to change the agenda a little bit. We're going to start off with number 2, B-398, BR-1315. That's the Southfield Funeral Home.
Through the chair, at the request of Mr. Yono, because he had to leave early last week and he has a funeral this evening, I requested that we move him up on the agenda. We had done an overview last week, but the commissioners did not have a chance to ask any questions of Mr. Yono. Mr. Yono didn't have a chance to present his concept. So if the commission would allow, I'd like to have Mr. Yono address the commission, answer any specific questions that you have, and then Mr. Spence and myself will be happy to answer any questions on the planning side.
Okay, sounds good. Okay, just state your name and address again.
My name is Jerry Yono, 18338 West Belmire Road. I own Southfield Funeral Home. I've been there for 32 years.
Okay. Yeah, just please give us an overview of your plan.
What I would like to do is, I purchased the homes that are right behind the parking lot, behind the funeral home, just so that we have more parking for our invitees, and that they would not be parking all over in the streets. It would bring in about another 100 car parking. We'd have approximately 150 car parking. We put in, I believe it was 41 cars, maybe 7 years ago, and that helped quite a bit. But now with the parking we might be losing, we definitely have to have that parking in the back.
Through the chair.
Yes,
sir. You know, if you wouldn't mind making your comments to the commission.
I'm sorry.
But in any event, we talked briefly today.
Yes.
And I had mentioned to you about the concerns about cars turning out of your parking lot on Guy Street and going north. And you had indicated that you would be okay with left-hand turn only.
I have no problem with
that. And you had also said that you would be willing to work with us on moving the driveway a little bit further north.
Yes. Whatever it's going to make it work, make it easy for everyone, I have no problem with it.
Now, just to remind the commission, we're actually here tonight to make a recommendation on rezoning from single family to vehicular parking and the vacation of Kesh Street. And the plan would actually be part of an administrative review, but it doesn't hurt to talk about some of these issues in consideration of the rezoning.
Okay. Anything else you'd like to add?
No.
I think it's a good sign that you do need more parking. That tells us that your business must be doing pretty good.
Well, we have large funerals, and we try to accommodate as much as we can as far as parking is concerned, but it's not enough. We definitely need that parking in the back. And I'm sure that all the neighbors can tell that we keep it nice and clean, and always will do that.
And if I could remind the commission that since the vehicular parking will be immediately adjacent to residential, a decorative masonry wall would be required and is included in the proposed plans.
Any other questions from any commissioners?
Yes.
Commissioner Bale.
Is this a revised plan here? Or is that where the drive going in on the guy's street?
Yes, it is.
It's
Okay.
I'm sorry.
If I may, staff is seeing this for the first time.
for a left-hand turn only with no right-hand turn.
I have another question. As far as your possession lines, are you going to line up any differently? Cars line up?
We really don't have any possessions whatsoever from that. And we don't ever have anything in the morning as far as funerals from there. We mostly go to the church. So we really don't have anything going in the morning. Once in a while, we may have someone, family come in, immediate burial, they'll be in there for an hour in the morning, and we head back to the church. So there's really nothing in the mornings at the funeral home. Most of the time, most of the visitation is from 4 until 8 p.m. in the evening. Sundays, 2 to 6. So it's just a four-hour visitation. Yes, sir. Question.
Hypothetically, if you have a large funeral procession and you are sharing that parking lot with the proposed Kmart proposal, so if you have a long procession, a lot of cars, who's going to block off the areas in the back of the church for parking for your people? You're sharing it with Kmart. And you have Walmart. You share it with Walmart, and you have a funeral. Who's going to be responsible for making sure that you have enough people to come back in that park? You're going to have to block it off with cones or something because you got people coming from Walmart parking back there. They're going to park where they can.
Walmart, I don't expect really a lot of people or any people coming from Walmart, to be honest with you. The opening in the back of the new park. Right back here.
Okay.
That's what we're talking about. Right back here.
Right.
That's the connection to Walmart.
Right.
And the new opening is right over there, and of course, the cars will be coming from the front on 12 Mile. So, really, people can come in through here. People can go out through here. So that way, it won't be any congestion whatsoever.
Okay.
But we're not going to have anybody standing there directing them.
Okay, so you perceive if there is not a funeral going on, a lot of those places will be empty.
It could be, yeah, if we don't have any. And I don't expect the parking lot to be packed every day, or every funeral, rather.
Okay.
Yeah. So that should. But if we have an overflow, then they will go into Walmart parking lot. That's why we put the opening there.
If I may through the chair, is that not your question, though?
The question was,
if you do have an issue of overflow and you do have to actually park on the Walmart site, are there sections of the parking lot on Walmart's property that will be sectioned off, and who will do that? Who will actually know which parking space are going to be used for your...
There won't be anybody there. People are just going there and
they just park where they find a spot.
Yeah,
whether it's on your side of Walmart.
Sure, wherever they find a spot there. And then that, on the side that we're talking about, I think they're going to have the flowers and gardening area. It's going to be a gardening area in that area. That's fine.
Okay.
Where's 12 Mile Road on that?
Commissioner Alien.
Yes. With the location of the, referring again to the exit onto Guy Street, is that this drawing isn't pretty far enough to the west to show what I want to be talking about very well. But people technically could come in on Guy Street, go in there, go across your parking lot, and into Walmart. And you got me.
They want that from there. They're only going to be going out to the left. They're not going to be able to go to the right.
But there's nothing to prevent them from coming in that way and going out that way. Is there?
Probably not.
Should there be? I'm just observing.
Probably not. I mean, if I may, the chair, can you clarify? I'm having a hard time understanding what you're...
Okay. That exit going to the west onto Guy Street?
So it's right here.
Yes.
Okay.
Is there anything that says that people that learn this, and everybody in the neighborhood is going to know it because people this morning to make a turn into Walmart that is congested right there at the entrance over 12 mile on the Wal-mart. If that's congested, then people can turn into Guy Street, turn in there, go across the parking lot, and go into Wal-mart. Is that not true?
I think that it's possible that people would do that.
Well, I know 12 miles really, really well. And when it's backed up going east, people will actually use Guy Street just to get out of traffic if they want to turn to the north. And they'll use Guy Street if they know the subdivision, to cut through the subdivision and come back out on Webster. And so I'm just pointing out what I think could be a problem, particularly during Easter, Christmas, etc.
Through the chair, and I'll let you answer.
Sure.
I mean, it's our intent to request traffic control signs that there's no through traffic to the north. And I know that Nick's subdivision doesn't exit out, just circles around and back out.
But it also goes through the neighborhood. Well, just as long as it's all accurate, yes. I'm just trying to point out something.
We could also request traffic controls about no through traffic. And I believe that Rob has indicated that the improvements to 12 Mile and Southfield should alleviate some of the existing stacking that you're currently experiencing. That's correct.
Yes, if I may also.
If I could, just a moment. As I so rudely interrupted the planner, people can go into Guy Street, and it doesn't just go around and around. You can go out into the rest of that subdivision very easily.
Can I say something?
Yeah, go ahead.
The invitees that come in, the visitors that come into the funeral home, all of them are Chaldeans. I don't know anyone that lives that area behind there. So they're not going to make a right turn because they'd get lost.
Okay. I'm not concerned about the people that are coming to your funeral home.
No, but I understand, but I just want to let you know that going in there, using those streets, it's not going to be busy.
No,
nobody's going to go through there.
From people from the funeral home, I understand that.
Yeah, if I may, too. I mean, we took your comments from last week, and I think you'll see through the Wal-mart presentation, too. We took a lot of what you said last week, and we went back, and hopefully you'll see that we did make some pretty good changes. One of the things we did was we did shift that driveway a lot further north, and that's what was requested. Now, to try and stop people from doing this, no, but to try and go through a parking lot and use it as a cut-through, now that it's even offset even further, is certainly going to be very difficult. Will people do it? There might be one or two, but will it be a very prominent movement? I would say absolutely not. I know for sure that I would not try and do this, make my way through a funeral home parking lot and into the back of the Wal-mart. I certainly wouldn't do that myself, and it's one of the reasons we went back to the drawing board, and we took your advice, and we talked to Mr. Yono, and he agreed as well as to try and shift this driveway a little further north and try and make it a right in and a left out. And again, we took a lot of your advice last week, and we thought, yeah, you know, this might be a good idea to help prevent not only cut through, but to move this driveway back a little further. So hopefully you see it's a good thing that we did and not a bad thing.
If I could, I do think it's a good thing. I think it's an improvement.
Sure.
But I'm just pointing out what could happen.
Absolutely.
That's all I'm doing.
And I wouldn't deny that. It certainly could happen. Whether it happens frequently, I would say that I would guesstimate as a traffic engineer that it would not happen frequently.
Okay. Mr. Peoples.
I just want to know, traffic-wise, do they have to have an entrance or exit onto that street at all?
That right now would be the only access other than a shared to make a left out onto 12 Mile Road, because they can't make a left here. They'd have to snake all the way through the Wal-mart to get out of the funeral home.
Okay, because they're not coming out at that one closer that south.
This right here, you can't make a left out onto 12 Mile. So this right here is a very important access point
for the funeral home. And
make them left out for 12.
But not only that, to have people come in, and Mr. Yono would know his operation, but to have people come in, you know, and eventually circulate through and then back out. You know,
there's already
funeral,
a cut already there?
Yes, there is. The existing cut is right here, and we took that and moved it further north and made it more, you see, it's more of a curve to try and prevent anybody from turning right.
So it's edges so it go left.
Yeah, and I believe that was the comment that was made last, you know, we're willing to work with you, and I, you know, we thought that that was a pretty good idea.
Well, that's what that looked like. I just wanted to make sure.
No, that's a good question.
But I was wondering if they had the open, you have to function, no question about that. I was just asking because I'm not sure how these operate.
And as a matter of fact, this location here is pretty close to the existing location where Kesh Street is. So it's very close, which obviously would be vacated to accommodate the additional parking.
Well, I will say this. I'm not saying I'm for or against or anything, but I don't see someone that wants to go to Kmart coming in over there. Who did it first? Okay. Well, I respect that. I don't see them driving all around to do that. I just don't see it, and I don't see people wanting to go into a funeral home. But people do.
And in addition to that, we are going to have the monument sign. It's this red sign right here. That's going to be the monument sign that's going to highlight that as the access point. I understand the concern.
People learn that, if the people that do learn that, to do that, they will do it.
Yeah.
So they can make that left turn instead of the right. So I could see them doing that. I'm trying to speak like I'm a resident right now.
And that's one of the reasons we did go back and try and make some adjustments. Thank you.
Any other questions or comments from the commission?
Yeah. It seems like it's a pretty big sea of parking without any landscaping or trees. What are your thoughts for any landscaping or out on the
whatever city requires, we will do. And we've done that, we did that the last time when we put additional parking, and it looks beautiful.
All of the, I guess, curbing is all just striped on the ground. There's that line, you know, which is probably what, a concrete stop in between.
This would all be grass area through here. This would all be, you know, grass and plantings. This part through here would be grass and plantings, and then all of this along here and all of that along there, and then the back wall area too would be some green space. The only part that would be striped are these little end islands in here.
And that's just a curb in the center there? Running.
Yeah, this would be, that's correct.
Chair, Commissioner Leitner, since the west property with the 6-foot-high wall, we'd rather have the landscaping concentrated on the outside perimeter to soften that wall. You're not going to be able to see in anyways. So in this particular case, you know, we would be in favor of highly landscaping the periphery. So it softens and screens the interior.
Commissioner Bill?
Yes. It's not part of the proposed extended parking lot actually part of the Wal-mart property?
I'm sorry, I don't know.
The current church property. If I am looking at that correctly, where that light green line is that not the property line for the church?
It is.
And so part of that proposed parking lot is actually part of the church property.
And it is right now.
Right. And I guess what I'm asking is this post, is this a shared site plan for them? I'm not sure how that works.
Well, through the chair, correct me if I'm wrong, isn't this piece being consolidated into Mr. Yono's property? So it's technically it's going to be lot split and consolidated into one parcel, and it's not going to be part of the proposed Wal-mart site. And this would, because it's vehicular parking, this will be handled administratively for review, separate from the site plan, should that go forward on the Wal-mart parcel.
wanted to clarify that. Thanks for the clarification. That helps a lot. Okay, any commissioners? Okay, you should be all set.
Thank you very much,
somebody in the audience wants to ask a question.
Okay.
My name is Fred Spencer. I'm 18352 Winterset Drive. I'm just being a guy. I have a question for Mr. Yona. I access my home by dry streets almost every night, and especially during the days of his visitations, there are periods there the backup to get into his facility is extreme. Out on the 12 mile, it's blocking the left-hand turn lane on the eastbound traffic as well as the traffic coming west. What I see in this plan is you have him either sharing the entranceway with Wal-mart, their trucking, and himself at that one lone input on 12 mile, which to me at certain hours is going to be an absolute traffic disaster. Mm-hmm. It's pretty bad now. It's controlled fairly well, but the traffic, and if you throw trucks in the middle of that, or a truck comes in and wants to get into that loading dock that's right there, you've got a mess on your hands. I just wanted to bring it up for consideration because I think it's going to really cause some traffic problems.
So, Yama, would you like to respond to that?
I don't know if those trucks, I think Walmart people can probably answer that question.
The Walmart truck traffic, and again, we'll get into some of that during the Walmart presentation, and I believe Mr. Kinks, Eric Kinks, talked about that last week, but the trucks are certainly confined to certain hours of the day, and there's only a few, as Mr. Kinks indicated last week, there's only a few trucks a day, and a lot of those would not necessarily be showing up during, I've known too that area. Certainly backs up around the 46 p.m. peak hour. And so Walmart, what they do is out of their, and again, Eric would be better to answer this, but during, out of their area where, their distribution area, they'll have the trucks schedule them around certain hours of the day so they don't hit that peak period of traffic that backs up. And so that certainly would be done at that point. And that driveway is actually, it hits the left house, which will certainly help. So it is a right in, right out, left
talking
in.
Input. People wanting to get into the funeral home.
Please speak to the chair.
I'm sorry, Kim.
As I was saying, I mean, that driveway prohibits the left out. And again, I don't want to get into the Walmart discussion right now, but that driveway right here was put together, was developed to get everything as far away from 12 Mile Southfield Road intersection, and combining two access driveways into one certainly makes sense from an access management perspective, and that's what we tried to do. And so we tried to make this access situation the absolute best we can. I certainly think we did with the site we're working with.
Okay, I don't want to get too much of the Walmart traffic flow plan at this point.
It's a combined site.
I just had a question, sir, for you. You were speaking of the Guy Street entrance?
No.
I misunderstood what you were speaking of.
I'm sorry. To clarify, I'm talking about the entrance off of 12 Mile. That's the only entrance off of 12 Mile. Right now, the entrance to the funeral home is on the inside of the home, so they come in, they have a separate driveway from like what St. Pete's. Okay? And they come in, and a lot of people have dropped off at that point. But there can be 4, 5, 6, 10 cars backed up on 12 Mile and or waiting to turn left into that driveway. Because that destination, usually when it starts, with a lot of traffic. I'm just saying, that seems to be dangerous, especially if you're adding the Walmart. Okay? Worst case scenario, if the holidays, November, December, there's a lot of traffic, okay? You have Murphy's Law come into effect, and you have the jam parking lot already, and they have a big visitation. I believe we've got a problem there. Okay? We've got a significant problem.
Well, I'm just wondering, because based on the site plan as I see it, I'm wondering if the extra parking would alleviate some of the backlog that's happening at that entrance. If the issue is there's a big visitation and there wasn't enough parking, Is the plan to extend the parking so that cars won't get backlogged right there, and that way they'll be able to pull into the funeral home?
That's correct.
And is it also the plan with respect to the new cut pulling back for people to use that as an entrance as well?
That's correct.
So is that the plan to kind of alleviate that backlog?
That is, and that's what was described last week. That's the reason we're here tonight is for Mr. Yono, is that additional parking is going to help the current situation. In addition, he's going to have two curb cuts right here, two access points to the Walmart development that would ultimately lead back around to the traffic signal. So it's certainly a better condition than what exists today with the additional parking. And I believe it's in excess of 90 parking spaces that would be added. Thank you.
I have a two-part question. The first question is, and maybe I missed it because I didn't get to the last meeting until the end of the meeting. Where will the left turn be from Southfield Road into Walmart? Because it appears, if I got it right, that the left turn lane going south and north will be shared. So you'll be able to, cars will be able to, if they're coming northbound, going southbound to 12 Mile, they'll be able to turn left at the gas station. If you're coming from the south headed north, will you be able to turn left currently where the House of Watch Bands is? And is that can you go through there to get to the funeral?
Through the chair, Ms. Gerald, would you mind holding that question until we actually get to the Walmart site? Because
I'm talking about the funeral home as well, too, if you're talking about that chair.
You're talking about left-hand turn from Edwards, and that's not dealing with...
Can you go left on Edwards to get to the funeral home in the Walmart development, since they'll be sharing the parking? That's the question.
Well, through the chair, there is access through the Walmart parking lot to the funeral home.
So it's important for someone to address the fact that you can turn left, go into Walmart's parking lot, and get to the funeral home.
And
so that's very important.
As I stated, they're going to do a presentation that's going to take us through that.
And then I want to ask another question. We're talking about the shared parking and the overflow. And then we're talking about the greenery and the shrubs. I was at Twickenham Valley Association meeting, and Councilman Ken Seiber showed up. And he mentioned something about code enforcement being changed, or either it is this way, I'm just not familiar, where now in houses or at houses, the bushes can't come beyond the window. So now you're talking about making all these shrubberies, covering up these things. Do you think that all of this greenery is eventually going to lead to, because you have theft in your stores, we have theft in all of the stores, Myers, and is that going to turn into a screening wall for criminal behavior with all the trucks?
Through the chair.
To cover up.
I'm familiar with Mr. Seiber through his housing subcommittee, neighborhood subcommittee. They're talking about adapting standards that shrubs have to be trained and maintained below the windowsill of homes, so that it appears that, you know, you can see in and out for crime prevention. And we use crime prevention through environmental design standards, as well as community policing, when we review all landscaping and site plans. There's a rule of thumb of no more than 30 inches evergreen hedge for height, so that people can't crouch behind that. And we use these principles when we do our site plan review and our landscaping review. And we would hold not only this site plan, but all site plans in the city to those standards.
So
but that's something
chair,
that's being explored.
Through the chair, how high are those shrubs or the trees that you're talking about will cover them? How high is it?
As I stated, our maximum is 30 inches high off the ground. And we'd like to have a clear zone between 30 inches and 70. So tree limbs have to be limbed up to 7 feet. Shrubs shouldn't be any higher than 30 inches. That's the clear vision zone that we maintain.
And through the chair, the tree limbs, are the leaves going to grow down, and is it going to eventually take up some of that space between 3 feet and 7 feet? Don't the limbs kind of expand and
it's the
leaves?
The property's property owner's responsibility to maintain the trees within our standards.
And through the chair, what's the tree standard for branches?
Okay, let me make this clear. This is not a public meeting. This is a planning commission study meeting. Okay, it's not. You'll get the opportunity at the public meeting, public hearing, to actually dialogue back and forth with us. But this is not really the place and time for it. But I will take questions if you have something that's
has not been brought up or that's relevant to the conversation.
Thank you. Leonard Lieberman, 29230 Guy Street. This young lady here made a good question about whether the parking is that. Right now, the funeral home uses St. Bede's parking. So there's a lot of parking there right now that they're going to lose because of that. But that's not the reason for the backups, because there's parking now. The backups are just a traffic problem. It has nothing to do with the parking.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, any other commissioners got any questions, comments? Okay, we're going to close this portion of the meeting. Thanks a lot for your time. We're going to move on to GP 1247, SP 1293. That's Tim Horton's restaurant.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is GP 1247, SP 1293. Special use and site plan review request of Patrick Bell, Tim Donut, U.S. Limited to construct a 1,953 gross square foot Tim Hortons restaurant with drive-through property located 19701 West 12 Mile Road, south side of West 12 Mile Road between Evergreen and Southfield Winthrop High School. The property itself, as you can see on the aerial photo, right there. Actually, let me go to the zoning first. Property itself is zoned B2, plan business, as well as the property directly to the west. To the east, we do have an RM zoning, single-family residential across the street. With regard to the existing uses on the property, the site itself is currently has a vacant Uptown Eatery restaurant on it. If you know this area, you know that there's been some difficulties with restaurants on these properties. It's been Mr. B's, it's been Uptown Eatery. The proposal here is for a 1,900 square foot Tim Hortons restaurant. Directly to the west, we have the Evergreen Plaza Shopping Center. We have multiple family directly to the east, and across the street, we have single family residential. If I may, I do know the representative of Tim Hortons is here. He does have a site plan, but he had you move your eyes back and forth. Colored site plan is on the other side there. I'm going to let him continue on from here for the moment.
Thank you, Patrick Bell, Tim Hortons, 565 East Grand River Avenue. Great question. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Commission Member. Yes, just following Mr. Spence's presentation, we're very excited about this new location in Southfield. It is one of our new Tim Hortons Cafe and Bake Shops. It also will have a drive-through component to it. Really what we're doing is we're going to demolish the existing Uptown Eatery, and this will be a new building, an entirely new site. The project itself will consist of a long-term ground lease on the property, and we're thrilled to be here, and I'd be happy to answer any questions you may have.
Mr. Beale.
How much of the site are you leasing? Just the shaded curb portion?
We will be leasing to this line right here.
So it's not the entire shaded portion that you're leasing?
No, this shows the improvements that we'll be making to the curb cut that exists with the shopping center.
Okay, so you're not leasing that, but you'll be using that?
That's correct.
And making improvements to it?
Yes.
Including the fencing, right?
Including the fencing.
And is the rest of that parking lot to the, what is that?
That would be to the south.
To the south? Is that going to be barricaded off? Or?
At this point, I believe it's the intention of the property owner to leave it open, make any repairs that are necessary based on the review by the by staff. And I don't know what their intentions with the remainder of the property are moving forward.
Commissioner Cole.
question. I went through there today, and I was looking at your drive-through for your parking area. Are you going to have this? So you got the driveway, and you got the cleaners to your right on the east side. The cleaners.
Okay.
Are you going to have drive-through to come through? Because the way it's situated now, you can come off of 12 Mile, or you can come into the cleaners and have a bagel place there. You can come into the area and go right into the current uptown.
No.
Are you going to block that off to keep?
This will be closed off. This will be curved.
Well, you going okay
along here, and there will be landscaping in this area. We're looking to relocate the curb cut that exists on the site further to the west to get a more cohesive and
okay.
And
so it'll be encompassing one. It won't be like it is now. So you
that's
right.
That
okay.
is correct.
All right, I understand. Okay.
Okay. Any other questions?
With respect to the plan, you have the dumpster enclosure. That is different from the one that exists right here at 10 Mile and Evergreen. Is that correct? Because it looks like those are open. Is this the plan to? It looks like these are closed off.
Yes, they are gated.
Okay.
With vinyl gates.
Okay.
They're wood grain vinyl gates.
Wood grain vinyl gates. Okay. And I don't know if you're familiar, but is that different than the 10 Mile and Evergreen?
It probably is. I'm not familiar with that location, but yes, I'm sure it's different.
And then you have a location also for your delivery trucks also, right?
Yeah, typically deliveries occur in off hours, and our normal busy hours are 6 to 10 in the morning, and the deliveries are outside of those hours. Normally we get 1 to 2 deliveries a week. Typically what happens is the truck will access the site, stop right about in this location. These are normally employee parking spots, and they'll offload here and then exit.
Okay. Through the chair, can I just ask a clarification? You said wood grain vinyl slab for the gate of the dumpster?
Yes. Is that kind of what's open?
Well, I would be in favor of vinyl, unless it's. I guess we'll need to see a product spec sheet on that.
Yeah. I'll bring a sample to next meeting. Yeah, they're not. They're like a solid.
Okay.
But let's call it a composite.
All right. When you. My vision of vinyl slats are the kind you stick through a chain link fence.
No, great.
Yeah. I guess we want to feel comfortable that this is a durable,
understood. Solid
material.
Absolutely understood.
Looking at your dumpster enclosure,
yes.
Is this the brick brownstone fence? Is that how the dumpster is going to be enclosed?
Yes. It will be brick to match the building. Yes.
This drawing shows a much wider opening coming in off the 12 Mile Road, and so you're reclosing off the current one that's further to the east. Is
correct.
That right?
Yes.
And moving this one closer to the main entrance to the rear of the strip center.
Yeah, the rear access to the strip center. Correct.
It looks like it's very close. In fact, almost right adjacent to it.
Yeah, they are pretty close to each other. That access on the shopping center there, I don't think is utilized as much as some of the other access points on there.
Right.
But
it's utilized by trucks going to the rear of the building.
Sure, absolutely.
And employees.
Yeah, and typically they're exiting out that way because of the configuration of the shopping center,
right.
And their delivery drops, and they would be exiting typically out that way. We do have the plans into Oakland County Road Commission for their review.
I beg your pardon?
We have the plans, because that is 12 Mile Road there is under the jurisdiction of Oakland County.
Right.
We do have that in to them for their review to see what their comments are also on that.
So they haven't responded yet?
Well, they have, but at this point we don't have a formal response. Their initial response was very favorable to that location.
For the entrance to be moved adjacent to
the
other.
Yes, just exactly what you see there. Yes.
Well, I'm concerned about that personally, and I'm also concerned about isolating a piece of a parking lot back here. And also the speaker is going to be facing a residential area 50 feet to the east.
Yeah, our speaker systems Today in the quick serve restaurant industry, speaker systems aren't what you probably saw in the past. They actually adjust themselves automatically to ambient background noise. So the conversation that we're having here, actually probably a little less than this, is what you'll normally hear at a speaker. It's just like you're standing next to each other. That sound doesn't travel very far at all. Plus, there is a screening wall along the residential property. We talked about, you know, our repairs to that. And we will, you know, have some landscaping in that area, too, to deaden any sound. Yeah, and we can adjust those speakers also.
You know, if I may, Mr. Chair, we do have, as we have on other restaurants like these in the past, most recently, I think we had another Taco Bell Burger King, we do have standards within the zoning ordinance that states that you have to be at a certain decibel level at the property line, and it can't be heard 100 feet from the unit itself. We'll make sure that those conditions are part of site plan approval.
100 feet would be 50 feet inside the residential property.
It's to be inaudible within 100 feet of the unit itself. But it has to be certain decibel level, 50 at property line.
You also have a digital order board also. Just
it will be a digital order board. Order board, yeah.
Oh, just it's going to be a single line, or it's going to be like a double line?
The drive-through itself?
Yeah.
It is a single line with an escape lane that goes around it. That's what you see here is the escape lane. So anybody gets over here and they decide, well, you know, I didn't want my coffee this morning, which I hardly believe anybody would do. They would go around and exit the site.
That's always good.
Right.
And the hours of operation again?
Our hours of operation are 24 hours. Typically what you'll see, a lot of this is up to the franchisee, but typically what you'll see is the dining room itself is usually open somewhere between 5 and 6 o'clock in the mornings, and they'll close maybe 9, 10 or 9, but the drive-thru itself is open 24 hours.
Okay.
Just want to compliment you on the site layout. It's really efficient, smooth, in and out, makes a lot of sense. Really like the outdoor seating area. 12-mile road. I think we need more pedestrian activity and just more action on the streets in general in the area. And I also understand it'd be extremely burdensome to you to improve the entire site that you're not using. So it makes a lot of sense. You're improving what you're using, leave the rest for future development, and go from there. I think it's a good building.
Thank you.
Look forward to seeing it.
Okay, there's any questions?
I just wanted to comment about the site before. It has a curb cut to the east, and then the other cut is in that same area that we were talking about where the other people have their incoming drop-off.
Right.
Uh-huh. So that was being used. I remember going to this site and coming in over there.
Right.
Instead of the new way you had it here.
Yeah, currently, as the site exists, you can kind of come in here and dive right into the site. We are going to close that off.
You're going to close that off.
Right,
okay.
So you will not be able to do that anymore.
Then you keep most of the traffic on your property.
It's our intention to isolate our traffic to our site. We're not burdened any other site.
Okay, if there's no other,
if I may, through the chair, just with regard to the site plan itself, they do meet the parking requirements. 17 are required for the property itself. With the lease property, I believe there's 32 on the lease property itself, so it's almost twice what they require. They also have the back parking lot as well, which they need to kind of overflow. Meet all the setback requirements. B3 requires 50 feet all the way around. They do meet all the setback requirements for the building. They're well over on the landscaping requirements as well. So they do meet the zoning ordinance requirements for parking, setbacks, landscaping, building height.
Thank you. Okay. Well, that's it. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, next on the agenda. DR 1314 SP 1291 Wal-mart.
Through the chair, since I know we have some new faces here tonight, I'm going to ask that the Walmart representatives go through their PowerPoint presentation again, maybe a little bit tighter than last week, but give the opportunity for audience who was not here last week to get an overview. And then, because staff had already done made their recommendations and comments, we'd be happy to answer specific questions after their presentation.
Could you speak up? I can't hear you.
Normally, when we have a meeting like now, it's a study meeting. Sometimes we want to get feedback from the audience rather than light up the public. I was just wondering if anyone had a few concerns about the sound.
Why do they want to be 24 hours? Through the chair.
That's their business model. That's business. And mainly, this drive-thru is 24 hours, from what I understand.
And then through the chair, you know, they're talking about the old restaurant location. When you're leaving, say, the Dress Barn, and you're coming out of Kroger on the 12-mile side where CVS is, there's like a little stop sign right there that tells people to stop there. And they don't stop. It's sometimes congested there because you do have cars coming from Southfield Road towards Evergreen. They turn left in there, and I'm one of those people. And the traffic there is really, really bad with cars trying to get in there and get out and go in the different direction. It's a pretty bad spot there. I need to explore that a little bit more.
Okay. Okay, we'll move on. Okay, Walmart, please.
Mr. Chairman, Eric Haynes, Walmart Public Affairs. Robert is with me again this evening, so as staff recommended, we'll run through a briefer version of what we did last week, and then certainly defer to the chairman and commissioners and staff for specific questions that you would like us to respond to. So I'll have Robert start out. I had gone through some of these things again last week, and again, I'll be brief from the store itself. And what a supercenter is. The proposed store location for this site is a 130,000 square foot store. A standard Walmart supercenter is a 184,000 square foot store. So this proposed location is about 50,000 square feet smaller than you would see at a normal, prototypical Walmart supercenter. Supercenter will include full grocery complement in addition to general merchandise. Again, a prototypical store at 184 would be about 300 employees at the store. Based on this size, and there'll be some flexibility that the store manager will have to have, but we're talking about staffing in probably the 240 to 270 employee range. Some of these are just very generic points about what we do at the location, number of property tax on this current site, what we estimate to generate is about $350,000 on an annual basis. I think it breaks out to roughly about a third of that would end up being for the City of Southfield's general fund. And of course, it would be up to the residents and their elected officials on how that general fund revenue increase would be allocated. Some of the other benefits from Walmart, the community, done a number of charitable things throughout the year, continue to do. In addition to just the immediate response to loads that were impacted from the storms out east in New York and New Jersey, these are some of the specific numbers here of what Walmart means to the state of Michigan. Some of the recent charitable contributions from 2011, just about $22 million in grants and donations. Some of the more local groups here that residents might be more familiar with. And then what we do by way of business here in the state of Michigan. We have 32,000 employees for Walmart that work here in the state of Michigan. Those 32,000 employees in our business generates about $4.2 billion with suppliers here in the state of Michigan. And that estimates from Dun & Bradstreet about 62,000 additional supplier jobs as a result of all the economic impact that Walmart has in the state of Michigan. And I'll turn it over to Robert to kind of walk through the site itself directly.
Thank you, Eric. Good evening,
Robert Matko, CESO, out of Lansing, Michigan. Good to see you all again this evening. Oh, again, I will make this a little briefer tonight and to try and hit specifically on some of the changes or some of the things we went back and we took some of your comments last week. So I'll focus on that maybe a little bit more. But I do want to, again, just walk us through some of the rezoning, because our request is also to rezone the parcel as well as site plan approval. And we already covered Mr. Yono's, but the rezoning for his parcel would be primarily the rear, few lots in the rear, and as well as Cash Street, which would also include the vacation. And you can see here that the existing zoning for the Walmart parcel, which is this area, this rectangular area here, a portion of that where the church is located, approximately 9.5 acres, is currently zoned single family. And then you can see here in the back, a lot of this portion is B2, which is planned business. And we propose to rezone the Walmart parcel to a B3 rezoning. And you can kind of see the rectangular piece here. And that would result in a little over 12.5 acres, just shy of 13-acre total parcel. You can see down here with the Yono Funeral Home, the proposed zoning there, which would allow for additional parking, and again would be vehicular parking. We walked through this slide last week, and this just shows an overview of what the current site looks like. There, obviously, if you drove on the site, you can see some of the parking lot is really failing, as well as, and I'm not sure how many of you have been out there, but even the wall surrounding the parking, the existing wall, is in bad shape. It's kind of a whitish color. Over the years, it even is darker in some areas, so obviously that is in bad need of being replaced. You know, what Walmart is proposing to do, this slide here just shows what is to remain and what is to be removed. You can see everything in blue here is what would be demolished to facilitate the Walmart construction. You can see here, this is the St. Bede Church, this area. This blue area right in here is an existing portion of a shopping center that does have Einstein Bagels in it, and it's a watch place, and a few other vacant kind of areas. This area to the red, or shown in red, is the existing shopping center to the north. It used to have a Kenzie restaurant in it. That is to remain and is not part of the Walmart development. So again, the Walmart property line would end up being right in this area. So this area is off Walmart's area and is not controlled by Walmart. You can see over here is the Yono or Southfield Funeral Home area. This slide also shows many of the existing curb cuts around the site that would be closed and removed. You know, a lot of these access drives here, if something else did develop, obviously could potentially have access to either Southfield Road or 12 Mile Road in those areas. And again, as stated, the Walmart plan is to remove those and utilize an existing access drive, which is the signal at Edwards Avenue, and combined with the funeral home, another access point on 12 Mile Road. This just shows the area grocery stores in a 2 mile radius. You can see in the middle there with the blue, that is the proposed Walmart Supercenter, and it just shows again some of the surrounding grocery stores in the area. This gives just an overview of the Walmart site plan. Again, it's approximately 130,124 square foot development. It is a super center, as Eric had indicated, so it will have a grocery and general merchandise component. The blue here is proposed parking. You can see up here in Southfield Funeral Home, the blue is their proposed parking as well. This kind of a lighter cyan color is parking, obviously, that's existing that would remain and is off the Walmart site. You can see here again the access. This would be a three-lane access driveway that leads to existing signal at Edwards Avenue. And again, as discussed, this access point as far as possible from the intersection of 12 Mile Southfield Road would be along the west property line, and again would be a right-in, right-out, left-in, so the left-out would be prohibited.
We've talked about this for the Yono Funeral Home, so I won't get too much into that. We go to the parking summary. I believe one of the commissioners had asked for a slide of this, so hopefully you did receive that. This just gives a breakdown of the parking, the proposed parking for the site. The Walmart proposed 623 parking spaces. Required by zoning ordinance would be 683 parking spaces. The funeral home currently has 64 parking spaces. Proposed would be 152 parking spaces. They're only required to have 47. The strip center existing is 176. Proposed is 146. And required is 265. Now, what happened with that required where that asterisk is there was a waiver granted prior that was granted for, where's that here, it was well over, it was 91 parking spaces. You know, obviously the Walmart site at this point is not requesting a waiver, but it is overall short 74 parking spaces. It's about 6 to 7% shortage, but there will be cross parking between all three entities. And that's something important to keep in mind. So cross parking will be achieved between all three entities, the funeral home, the Walmart, and the shopping center.
So it's shared parking? There's a shared parking agreement with all three entities?
Yes.
Is that what you're saying?
Yes, that is correct. This slide just shows, it gives some idea on the green space. Required by ordinance is just shy of 15,075 square feet. We're going to be proposing over 22,000 square feet of green space. That does not include some of the area here that will be dedicated to the county for future improvements along Southfield Road. You can see here, as discussed in our prior meeting, that will be a berm. It will be 8 feet in height with 8 foot tall staggered evergreens on top of. In addition to that, we are going to have landscaping along the Southfield Funeral Home, as well as a 8 foot wall that will extend from Guy Street all the way along the north property line of the funeral home and then along the west property line of Walmart, and would then meet the existing wall just north of the Walmart proposed property line. And again, we'll be 8 feet in height and again, a brand new wall. Traffic, we did conduct a traffic impact study for this site. As indicated, the Road Commission has reviewed that study and concurs with the findings in the study. We did look at several key intersections, with obviously the primary intersection being 12 Mile and Southfield Road. Obviously, there are current issues at that intersection, specifically with the west leg of the intersection. And as I noted last week, Walmart would be contributing zero volume to that west leg. It's one of the reasons we have the access driveway on 12 Mile Road as far from the intersection as possible. In addition to that, Walmart would be contributing less than 5% to that intersection. Southfield Road currently has approximately 48,000 vehicles on it. And again, Walmart would be adding to the intersection of Southfield and 12 Mile less than 5%. Increase in traffic. Also, as stated last week, there will be pass-by trips for this site. ITE estimates as much as 28%. In our study, we actually decreased that a little and used 24% as pass-by trips. And again, those are trips that are not destined for the Walmart. They might be passing by the site and decide to stop in. So it's not considered a new trip, but a trip that would be taken from the existing traffic. You can see here what the site, the proposed Walmart trips would be generated. What we're looking at is, obviously in the AM peak hour, the site does not generate as much trips. The weekday PM peak hour does increase a little bit, but still it doesn't coincide necessarily with the peak of Walmart. I already went over the pass-by trips. Some of the traffic recommendations. We are recommending a right-in, right-out, left-in driveway on 12 Mile Road, so the left turnout would be prohibited. We're recommending combining that driveway approach with the funeral home. We're also recommending over a 400-foot right turn lane into that driveway. In addition, we are recommending at the intersection of 12 Mile Road and Southfield Road, we're going to be recommending that entire signal be completely removed and replaced. As indicated last night, I called a simple span or a diagonal span signal, which means it just has two poles. You can see here the picture shows the current signal at this intersection. You can see signal heads are a little hard to see. It's just a two-pole. There's one pole and there's the other pole on the other side of the intersection. Signal heads are spaced very far apart. This intersection is well over 10 to 15 years old, obviously in need of modernization. Wal-mart will be modernizing this signal, and we are looking at going with a mast arm installation, very much what you see here, some decorative poles, some nice lighting on it. You can see the mast arm, how it spaces the signals out, the signal heads. We also have the pedestrian signal heads right on the pole. Again, it's going to space everything out. And modernize the intersection. In addition to that, we are going to have right turn overlaps, and I believe one of the commissioners last week, had a comment about the southbound to westbound right turn lane. That right turn lane currently backs up during weekday PM peak hour 187 feet. That's through the synchro analysis that was done. With the right turn overlaps that's proposed, that right turn lane would drop to 99 feet. So it is a significant improvement with that right turn overlap. And what that is when your left turn phase, your left turn arrows come on, your opposite or opposing right turn lanes would receive a right turn green arrow, and they would be able to go when, the north-south-left movement were going, the east-west-right could then go as well. And that will significantly help. In addition to that, we are going to be removing and replacing the existing signal at Edwards Avenue, and it also is going to be identical to the mast arm and decorative poles that are being shown at 12 Mile Southfield Road. So this design would be incorporated at Edwards as well. New controllers, new video cameras. You're talking in excess of $500,000 worth of improvements.
Through the chair, just to point out too, Robert, that part of our recommendations and our discussion is the internally illuminated
yes.
street sign, which is will make a big difference
that
if people are approaching.
That is correct. And that is something that would be done on the signal as well. If you've seen some of the internally illuminated signs, they're a real nice feature. They really show what the street is. All of this is going to help the overall intersection. The Road Commission has agreed. They have stated that these improvements will improve the intersection, the current overall operation of this intersection. As we go again up to Edwards Avenue, we're also going to be, initially, early on, we had shown that as just a two-lane section. We ended up widening that to a three-lane section into the Wal-mart site. What that's going to do is it's going to allow any left-turn vehicles to get out of the through lane internal to Wal-mart, and it's going to allow Edwards Avenue to function much better. So you can see there are a lot of different things that we've done with this signal. I think that will be a significant improvement over what is currently there. Some other concerns from our last meeting. There were some questions that were raised about the parking lot lighting. This site will be furnished with LED lighting. You can see here, this is how the site would look. This gives a good overview of the LED lighting. I'm sure some of you have seen LED lighting even with me. I've switched over some of my home Christmas lights to LED, and it's kind of a whiter, cleaner looking light. Some of the older style gives it more of a goldish color. So again, you can see it'll give a nice white look to the parking lot. Now this, you can see it's very dark. This is actually on the other side of the wall. You can see there's zero light spillover on the wall. Now granted, if you look right at the lights, you're going to see them if you look directly at them. But as far as spillover, we're looking at 0 foot candles beyond the wall. And we're going to have a wall very similar to this. But this one may be 6 feet, where ours is actually going to be an 8 foot tall wall. We already went over extending the southbound, about the right turn lane at 187 feet to 99 with the right turn overlap. The funeral access drive on Guy Street, again, we took some of your concerns back. I think we reworked that drive. Hopefully, this is something what the Planning Commission was looking at. We think it's a good idea for traffic circulation as well, and so it has been implemented into the plans.
And with that, I'd like to turn it over to Christopher Shears, if it's okay with you.
Yeah,
he can quickly go through the building elevations. Thank you very much.
My name is Christopher Shears. I'm also with CESO. Last week, we kind of went over, or actually, before I get too far along and I forget again, I brought a material board, just to kind of give the board an idea of some of the materials that we are proposing to use. In addition to that board, there are two sample boards right here against the glass, which are the brick material also. Just to kind of give you an idea of some of the quality of materials that we've upgraded this building instead of just using a bunch of paint and CMU. Instead of using a lot of painted objects, we've upgraded them to having integrally colored products. Those give you an example of some of the glass that we're using and some of the other products on the building. This store was upgraded throughout, especially on the sides that face Southfield Rd and the side that faces the parking lot area, the most visible sides, because of access and pass-by. Along the front, additional windows were added. You can see that there's two samples of glass on that board, and that kind of gives you an idea of the clear glass, and then what we call spandrel glass, which has a tint behind it, so you can put it somewhere where you usually wouldn't be able to put clear glass in a surface area or, you know, a freezer or something like that. You can still have that look to upgrade the elevation. That gives you an idea of that. We've also added those spandrel glass windows along Southfield Rd. And then the red color here, that's the main building color, is the red brick that's over here on the wall. To give you an idea of what the main building color will look like and the variation in the material. It's not just all one color. And then the yellow kind of brown color here is the other brick back there, along with the accent blocks that are located on that board. This kind of gives you an idea, once again, of the layout of the store. The front entrances along this area, the grocery being along this area, which has a larger grocery than a normal store of the size, and then the garden center on the side facing the Southfield Funeral Home. The signage, once again, as we talked about, the access drive here on off 12 Mile, there will be a low monument sign to highlight that is the entrance off Southfield Rd to the site.
Can you stand behind us? You did get a complaint that you can't see. Could you do it from back here?
Okay. How about I do it from over here?
That way you won't have any complaints. Okay. Thank you.
He can block all down.
We also have the sign here down at the signal off of Southfield Rd. This sign here, but on the one on 12 Mile, we, after talking with the residents, we reduced that sign height to reduce any visibility from the neighborhood of that sign. It's only, I think it's 8 foot. Eyes aren't that good right now, but that's about the level it'll be at, so it won't be visible back from the neighborhood area. These kind of give you an idea of the front elevations for the parking lot, some of the upgrades. Entrance has had an added glass to it, which is an upgrade from a typical store to give a different look and to break up an area that's sometimes a little less articulated. This area right here where you see the crab apple trees, this is also where there's some benches where we've kind of put a seating area so that people waiting for rides or other transportation can have an area to rest that is out of kind of a normal traffic pattern area where it's not congested and people are and the cars are not as close to them. We will also have, for discussions, we'll have a bike rack over in this area to allow the pedestrian access. If you remember, the pedestrian access from the neighborhood comes along that side, and so they can, if somebody has a bike that comes from the neighborhood over there, they can park it in that area. This will be the view from Southfield Rd heading south. You see a short fence with columns and decorative trees to give a nice streetscape along that side that currently we don't have. This element will be at the corner to provide an upgraded look and to also provide a seating area there at the corner of Southfield 12 Mile, along with evergreens along the rear to kind of last time, last meeting, we kind of had a couple of questions about some of the demolition of the existing building. Walmart will require their contractor to implement a recycling program for both the demolition waste and the any waste from the new construction. So they contract out with a company that manages all that, and they will recycle different elements, copper, different pieces, depending on what all is accepted in this area for recycling. And they have to report back to Walmart that they've met the thresholds of that, and if not, why they have not. And that is a part of the they will be recycling that material. Also, we talked about some of the trash and a dumpster kind of issue. Just again, this one will not have a dumpster. It will have a compactor so that the trash from the inside the store will be put directly into that. It won't be an open dumpster where if it's left open, stuff's going to be blown out. It's not that kind of situation. It is also screened along the back. It's in the service area, so it would be both screened visually and to help anything noise and anything from that area. It'll have the wall plus the berm along the back, and then there'll also be a recycling area for cardboard and plastics and things like that from the existing area. We're open to questions.
Mr. Chairman, last week there were a number of questions about asset protection, what we do inside the store to protect our customers, doing the parking lot. So we brought Samantha Stevens with me this evening. Samantha's asset protection manager for one of our Metro Detroit markets. If there are specific questions that you and the commissioners have about crime or what we do to respond to crime, or how we police our parking lot, Samantha's here to answer any and all questions that you all may have.
I'm just basically going to go over when a Walmart is set up in a community, how we set up our safety and security with our staff in our store. So based on the crime index and the surrounding retailers, we decide what our staffing is going to look like for asset protection. Usually it's about 4 to 5 associates that are going to protect the building inside and out. As far as cameras, usually there's over 200 standstill shots inside the camera or inside the store. And then on the perimeter of the building, on the outside of the building and on poles in the parking lot, we have cameras that actually surveil the entire parking lot. Usually there's very little space that's not covered by our parking lot cameras. We also have a relationship with the local police department with making apprehensions or any violent activity that might happen in the parking lot or within the building. For a 24-hour store like this building here, at night we do close off the grocery entrance. The GM entrance, only leaving open the grocery entrance so that you can only come in and exit through one side. As far as, you know, staffing at night, depending on the crime index, you know, in this area, what they're going to decide is if they're going to have parking lot patrol. They could have somebody who drives around the parking lot from 6 p.m. till 6 a.m. is usually what we do if we do decide to put parking lot security in the parking lot. Does anybody have any questions about security? I'm looking for that.
Is that armed security or just strictly unarmed
social? It's unarmed. They basically inside the store.
Inside and outside.
Okay. Inside the store, they are unarmed. If we have an issue where we need to call police, we don't have any armed associates inside the store. And then in the parking lot, it's strictly an outside security company that we hire, and they're in a vehicle. They don't touch anybody or really, they only communicate with our customers and associates in the parking lot if there's any issues.
Are they armed or unarmed?
Unarmed.
Inside and outside.
Inside and outside, yeah.
Mr. Chair, I know that each store varies, and you use the term crime index. I'm sure you've done your homework. What is the crime index that is anticipated for this area, in this store? Is it something? And again, we're just asking, and hopefully we got a better crime index than others, because you don't need the full security. But at your initial comments, and I know After talking to our police department and so forth.
To the question, I mean, the initial review is that it's a low crime area. It's not what you would consider to be a high crime area. But to that point, we're also waiting on some interaction, particularly with the police department directly. there's only so much data that we can compile as an outside entity. There's a lot of that information that we're still going to need from the chief of police, city staff, and other retailers in the area to make our final analysis. And it, as Samantha mentioned, we use all of that data in compiling the analysis that we utilize for each individual store. So the more high crime area, we know we're going to have to do more to protect our customers, to protect our associates, and so the store manager will have the leeway to look at utilizing, as Samantha said, a security detail that would patrol the physical location. If it's a low crime area, we don't see that number of incidents, then that's, again, the store manager, the market managers, and our regional asset folks will look at it, and they'll devise the plan for staffing based on those levels. Now, obviously, there are catastrophic events that happen in life. We can't account for all of those, but we used all of the available data that we have, and some of that is still yet to come to get a final number. But from the initial response, it looks great, and we expect, as I mentioned last week, our rates will be absolutely in line with what you're seeing with your other big box retailers in your community, whether it's Target, Home Depot up the road, or Meijer and Kroger that are within the 2 mile radius of us. Our numbers match exactly what their numbers are going to be.
Anyone else?
Thank you.
Can we still discuss it? Commissioner Bell?
Yes. The summary of the parking that's currently existing and being proposed shows 176 existing on the strip center. I don't know who I'm addressing with this.
Sure.
Is that 176 with the part of the shopping center that's left?
Yes, that's only the remaining portion.
Okay.
Or I'm sorry.
It would be the
where the Einstein Bagel is and the remaining portion.
So
it would be if you can get to this. It would be both the it'd be this port, yeah, if you can go to the it would be this area right in here, this parking and this parking here.
So how much parking would be left existing for the remaining shopping center?
That's on that slide as well. The 146.
Okay. So there's only 30 parking spaces on the part that's being torn down?
That is correct. It'd be mainly prep a little bit in this area and some right around in here, the front and the side. That is correct.
Okay, and I understand that there was a waiver given to that strip center at one point.
Yes.
For parking, but that waiver has gone away, will go away with the splitting of that property.
That's correct.
Correct?
That's correct. I mean, yes, we're showing a shortage of 74 spaces for the entire three developments added together. The prior waiver just for this one shopping center alone was for 91 parking spaces. So we're looking at just 74 would be for all three is what we're short for the parking.
Okay. I just wanted to understand that.
Sure.
When you were addressing earlier a concern about the traffic flow on southbound Southfield Road, you were talking about a partial remedy, at least for the situation you were talking about, was the right on red.
Yes.
I didn't hear addressed at all a concern that I expressed last week about the turn lane north of 12 Mile Road on Southfield Road, the turn lane for people that want to go, that are traveling south on Southfield Road and want to go east, want to turn left when you're going south. That turn lane oftentimes is stacked up past Edward Street. And so people that are going north on Southfield Road that want to turn west into the strip center and Walmart, we'll have no place to stack.
Yeah, sure.
Is there any...
Well,
any thought on that?
And again, I know you're basing all of this on existing. What is there right today? And the only
and
thing
and
I
are you doing anything to correct it?
Absolutely. For instance, those right turn overlaps are going to provide some additional capacity at that intersection.
In the left turn lane?
Absolutely. The signal by revising the signal timing as well. Mm-hmm. Plus, we are going to have a newer signal there. I mean, the signal will operate better than it currently does. As I used the analogy last week, it's like going from maybe a flip cell phone to maybe a smartphone. It's obviously going to be a much smarter intersection than what we currently have. And I think I used the, for instance, last week, and if you go out to that intersection, you sit there and you wonder, why is one leg backing up more than the other? Well, you know, there's some timing modifications and changes that do need to be made to that intersection. Now, using the SCAT system, which is the video camera detection, that is supposed to pick up where, you know, queue lengths are occurring and automatically adapt the timing to give more time to those legs of the intersection. Well, if you go out to the intersection right now, it's not quite working that way. You know, the north leg might be queuing up more than, say, the east leg. Well, what this new intersection will do is it will place the video detection around the intersection on the four poles. It'll better space it, and it will provide for a much better operation.
Isn't there a SCAT system there now?
There is a SCAT system, but again, it's mounted on a couple of poles.
It can't function very well when the traffic's too heavy, because it's not doing it, is it?
Yeah, well, I think that's the reason for the new step, why we're proposing a new signal.
And the new system is a SCAT system that has new lights on it.
That's correct.
Sorry, that's not convincing me that you're...
Well, you can see here, again, you know, this is what we're looking at. You know, the cameras would be mounted at the top. Well, you also space out your signal heads, and you put in a new controller, an entirely new controller that is modernized. I mean, there's a reason that the county goes around and modernizes a lot of these intersections. Am I telling you this intersection is going to improve two levels of service? Absolutely not. Will it mitigate Walmart's impact? Yes.
You mentioned also earlier that, if I heard you correctly, I'm not sure, that Walmart would be contributing less than 5% additional traffic to Southfield Road. Is that what I heard?
To the Southfield and 12-mile road intersection.
To
yes.
The intersection.
To
so
the intersection.
Going both ways. Is
that's
that
correct.
What you're saying?
That's correct.
And what? How many vehicles does that 5% amount to?
300. Yeah, it's approximately that in a 24-hour period. It'd be
bad. I didn't hear that.
It'd be approximately 100 vehicles an hour on average.
100 vehicles an hour times 24. I don't know.
Yeah, it'd be 2,400 vehicles. The ADT, or the total 24-hour traffic for the store, would be approximately 2,400 vehicles in, 2,400 vehicles out,
so
during a 24-hour period.
So that's 4,800 vehicles
total. Yes.
To that intersection.
Well, not all of them go to that intersection.
Oh, okay. I'm just trying to understand.
I know. I mean,
there's 48,000 vehicles on Southfield Road every day.
I believe you.
And
we can go back to
15,000 on 12 Mile. Is that right, Robert?
Yes. That's about 18,000. 18,000
on 12 Mile, 48,000 on Southfield Road. Today. What we're saying is that we're going to generate another 2,400 inbound and outbound for about 5% to that intersection. And what Robert's describing with the traffic signal is, the traffic signal improvements will far outweigh the mitigation of that. So our impact, we're assuming, is going to be more than offset by the signal improvements. Now, whether it vastly improves the existing situation or not, is not a conversation that we can have. I mean, that's something that you've got to have with your road commission, and you've got to have with your city council members, and that's a whole other issue. We think it'll be better. We think the new signal and the right turns in particular will be a lot better. But what we're trying to tell you is that we are proposing, what we have proposed here, is going to do everything we can do to mitigate our impact on that intersection, both from the traffic inside the intersection to what Robert described with moving those access points as far away from the intersection as we can possibly get. To your point earlier about a northbound traveler that wants to turn left to go into Walmart, my answer to that is, why wouldn't they be in the left turn lane south, 12 Mile, and utilize the left turn lane to make the left turn movement and then turn right into Walmart, as opposed to going through Southfield Road to turn left against a queue that's backed up.
They don't know it's backed up till they get there.
And some people won't know that on their first trip. And when they go on their second trip, they will. And if they're there at 5 o'clock on a Friday afternoon, they're going to be in trouble. And if they're there at 4 o'clock on a Saturday,
what we can do for
it
next
may be way different.
What we can do for next week, too, is we can show you a slide that shows what Walmart is projecting at this intersection. For instance, you may quickly do the math and say, that sounds like close to 10%, but vehicles coming out of here, say there's 20% traffic coming to and from the east. They're not going to exit here, go to this signal, turn right onto 12 mile and go this way. They're going to come out here. That's 20% traffic that will not cross that intersection. Same thing here. A lot of this traffic coming from the east is going to turn left into here. It will not go through this intersection. So if you try to do quick math and say, well, 4,800 versus 65,000, that's about 8% right there. But not all of those vehicles are going to go through this intersection. And again, another thing to note, and I keep saying it, pass-by traffic is going to be very important for this site. With a big major generator, carrier of traffic like Southfield Road that carries over 48,000 vehicles per day, there is going to be, which we downgraded 24%, it could be as much as 35% pass-by trips. They're going to come off of the existing traffic that would be not counted as new trips. So next week we will have a slide that just shows what percentage of traffic goes through that intersection, if that would help.
Well, I know I'm familiar with the term pass-by traffic.
Sure.
I'm not 100% sure that I agree with everybody's definition of it, because just like when I want to leave the house on any day, Saturday, for instance, to go grocery shopping, and I want to go to the post office, and I want to go to three other places, because I want to conserve energy, mine as well as my automobile. But and so you can call that a pass-by visit if you want to, but I intended to go to Walmart.
Then that wouldn't be a pass-by
trip. And I intended to go to the post office.
You would be
so
a new trip.
I didn't pass by any of those. I went there because I wanted to go there.
And next week as well, I'll actually have the definition on a slide of pass-by, because the only way I can simply explain it is if you're going home tonight, and you're not intending leaving tonight and going straight to a Walmart. You're just intending to go home. But all of a sudden you see the Walmart, and all of a sudden you say, oh, you know, I have to pick up, I don't know, something for the kids. That's not a new trip. That's a pass-by trip. You were not destined for Walmart. Now, if you leave this meeting and you say, oh, I got to hurry and run to Walmart because I need to pick something up, you're a new trip. You're not a pass-by trip. So if that can be understood, there is going to be a significant amount of pass-by trips generated by this store on Southfield Road alone.
I'm hard-pressed to believe that it's going to be a lot of pass-by trips. People will indeed stop by Walmart on the way home. It won't be because, oh, I need to get milk.
The only thing I can state to the Planning Commission is we have tools in traffic engineering. The study that we did follows those recommended tools. And the tool that we used is the Institute of Transportation Engineers 8th Edition Trip Generation Manual. That is the tool. It's nationally accepted. They show as much as 28% pass-by trips. We use 24% in this analysis. That is what we can go by. That is more than fair and adequate for this analysis. And I think the Road Commission, I believe city staff as well, concur with how the trip generation and pass-by trips were done for this study.
I can't disagree with a study like that at all. I do disagree with how it came about, because I live there.
Sure.
And I know what happens there.
Sure.
And I know for a fact that anything we put there is going to generate more traffic.
Sure.
Anything.
Sure.
And this is such an intense development for that corner. It's going to be awful, traffic-wise. Yeah. I know that. And to paint it as it's not, it's going to be improved, is just deceiving.
Well, I think the only thing we're painting is we're trying to mitigate what impact Walmart would be doing. That's all we're trying to paint. Are we saying that we're going to improve that intersection where it's free flow? We're not saying that. But I understand your concern. Thank you.
Ready by yourself.
I would like to speak.
One thing I got a question too. I know you have a pickup point, drop off point for your trucks, but how about for customers? I know you have a large online presence. Do people order online and pick up at the store?
Yeah, we have Walmart.com. Does it in order to compete, particularly with folks like Amazon that get a 6% competitive advantage against us by not collecting Michigan sales tax. What Walmart.com does, there's a number of options you can use. Ship to store is basically how it works. So if you're going to a niece's birthday party, for example, and so you decide you're going to get her a present for the birthday, there are a couple options you can do. When you go on to Walmart.com, you could have it shipped directly right here to your hometown Southfield Walmart store, or if they happen to live in Troy or Rochester or one of the other locations, rather than picking it up at the Walmart store in your hometown Southfield, you might want to have it shipped to your niece's hometown. So then rather than you and your wife and the kids load up with the big bicycle in the car and then drive to the niece's home, you load everybody up in the car like we all do, and then when you get into town, wherever that might be, Rochester, et cetera, you stop by that local Walmart and actually pick up the item. We don't have specifically designed, like, you know, parking for that pickup in the parking lot, so if you do that, you order it online, you have it shipped to that store, whether it's the Southfield store or the Troy store or wherever it may be, you pull in the parking lot just like any other customer. If it's a good day and you get a front row spot, you pull into the front row and you walk right into the store. If it's a more busy day, like we'll be experiencing at our stores over the next week, you may be parking further back. In a circumstance like that, I mean, there is area up front where, you know, you may drop your wife off in the front of the store. She'll get out and go into the store. You go back and park, and then when she comes back out. But those are all movements that customers do at retail locations across. It's not specific to our location.
You anticipate less traffic actually coming to the store as opposed to online ordering in the future?
I mean, it's really hard to do the math on the online, and like I said, particularly with the competitive advantage that a lot of the online retailers have, that 6% price difference does matter. And I mean, if we were having this conversation 10 years ago, I think our conversation about online sales would be much different than it is today. So where it's going to be 10 years from now, the company's doing, you know, like every other retailer, we're trying to compete in the market. There's more convenience for the customer. For all I know, the folks in Bentonville are working on a ship-to-home program for Walmart.com. I don't know where it's going to be 10 years from now. There is a lot more traffic online, and that does change the way we have to respond to our customers and needs.
So I would assume there's going to be less foot traffic into the stores. That was my whole point. In the future.
In the future, you know, if it will be. But, you know, at the same time, I don't think it's a likely scenario for me to have a gallon of milk shipped to my house. So, where that starts to draw, where the line starts to draw, you know, when I grew up in Clinton Township, I worked for a home food service delivery company. So we delivered everything but bread, eggs, and milk right to your house. Those are the only things you ever had to leave.
Okay. I'm going to take a couple of follow-up commissioners off instead of being on time. Commissioner Leighton?
Do you have any bike racks located outside?
Yeah. We do. They're on the west portion of the store in front of, more towards the home and garden area.
Okay.
And again, the access point there is designed more particularly with that walkable access to the neighborhood that we described last week. That individuals walking or, you know, kids on the bike or whatever that come to the store through that access point, the bike racks would be closest to that location.
The other item that I was thinking is that since it's a shared parking agreement, that there should probably be some type of pedestrian access near the where the Kwanzai restaurant is, probably up in there. I think this development could energize that center and that parking. I think, you know, where they did have the existing parking over there, it might make sense to have some type of pedestrian access from that area. It looks like there's a little sidewalk that kind of wraps around the side of that building, maybe.
Yeah, there would be a sidewalk. What they would have to do is basically come right down here, walk along the walkway, and up right up to the store. The parking right now, we felt it was very important to get as much green space along the west property line as possible, and we put a lot of trees there. mean, we could have taken those trees out and put a walkway along there, but to have a walkway down through the middle, again, we're really squeezed on parking right now, but they do have access to this sidewalk right here, and this is going to be a brand new sidewalk along Southfield and a brand new sidewalk along 12 Mile Road. So they could come right over to here, walk down this sidewalk, and right up into the store.
Basically what I'm talking about is, like, if you look at the lower left corner of that, let's say, upper box, you know.
This up here?
Yeah. So the lower left corner of that building there.
Right here?
No, down, yeah.
Right here?
Yeah, right there. If you just had, like, maybe a painted access across from there over to that other parking on the asphalt. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Oh, a pedestrian walkway across
the Edwards
Drive.
Yeah, painted access.
Sure.
You know, it doesn't have to, you know, it could go into one of those curbs or, you know, landscape beds.
Another question we'll certainly look at.
Just kind of provide an access.
Sure. We'll look at
that. Because I know that it'll probably be, you know, busy traffic.
Sure.
You know, and people feel maybe a little more comfortable that they might not get run over.
Okay.
A couple compliments on the environmentally friendly features. I'm a big recycling advocate and a renovating advocate. That's something we strongly suggest when we tear a building down, is to recycle as much as possible and reuse as much as possible. So glad to hear that. I think you're a big and powerful enough company to make sure that happens with the contract and everything. So that's a really good thing for me. LED lighting is great. You know, it's the latest technology. It saves so much energy. Significant upfront cost that, again, I'm glad to see you're taking that on. I think it's going to be a good standard for, you know, future development that follows. And then I did drive by the Novi Town Center Walmart, and I guess that's the most recent example or similar example. And it's a very nice building. Novi has very high design standards. And then I just want to say that this is above and beyond that, in a nicer design,
Chris,
and more upgraded. And I'm happy to see that level of detail and extra material. You know, along the same lines too, the pedestrian space to the right of the entrance, and then small civic amenity out on 12 Mile Southfield Road. I think they're going to generate more of that activity again. Like I said about the Tim Hortons and the. You know, some of the shops right down the street here, there's a lot of action and more action throughout the day. I think this is going to be a good thing for this city as we move forward.
Just to piggyback on Commissioner's comments, and I forgot to ask this before, has Walmart implemented any vehicle charging stations in any of their buildings? Is that something you could at least consider?
Yeah, absolutely. It's something we could talk about. I know for the brand new Warren location, and I think we talked about that maybe last week. I apologize, Mr. Chairman. We've got a store just 2 miles up the road from the old Warren site, and now we're adding a new site, a brand new supercenter at the old Warren location. So we will have two operating supercenters within 2 miles of each other. Because of the proximity to the GM Tech Center, which is literally across Van Dyke Road from the new Warren location or the rehab Warren location, we're putting charging stations in that location. I think it's only four, but they're still working with. There's two separate vendors that provide that, and last time I checked in with them, they were trying to pick from which of those vendors. But if that's something that Planning Commission or City Council would like us to look at, then that's something we can absolutely look at.
Let me take a couple questions from the residents. Way back here, had a hand for quite a while.
Yes. I'm a 35-year resident of Southfield. My name's Colleen Bassett. And I wanted to tell the Planning Commission how excited I am about the possibility of this rezoning and getting Walmart. I mean, what could be better for our city? It's that ugly little corner we've been looking at for how many years, the sad property. We're gonna get new landscaping. We're gonna get new parking lots. We're gonna get new street lights. I mean, and besides that, I like Walmart. It's a good, reputable company. I mean, we need to look at these. I asked my planning commission to listen to how Walmart is trying to address residents' needs. They're doing an excellent job. And I ask you to keep your minds open. I think this is a wonderful opportunity for Southfield.
Okay. Thanks for your comments. Till we get here.
I'm Harvey Bunker, 9111 Group. I'm president of the Pampers of the Walmart Association. We have no real concerns about the Walmart except to. You mentioned earlier that we had a low crime rate in this area. We'd like to keep it that way. And one way to keep it that way is not to keep it open 24 hours. To make it easy for people to come in and out of the store after midnight. I would hate to see bad guys come in through the sidewalk after midnight into our neighborhood. You're making it easier by making a cut-through out of the funeral home's parking lot. We have concerns about people coming through the shared parking or driveway and turning on the guy's street and then also further down Rock Creek and making a left turn there to get on the 12th line going left. That's going to be a big traffic problem for our neighbors. You're not talking about backup on here at the corner on the shared driveway. You're just talking about backup in the residential area. So, you know, I like to keep my neighbors nice and safe, and that's the only way I can see that happening is to not have 24 hour store. We already have 8 stores in the area that are not 24 hours, and they're not hurting the business. I don't see why you have to keep this store open.
Okay, thank you.
A couple of questions. I've only been in Southfield. Next year will be, I think it's been about 30 years. I haven't been here quite as long as
you're a newcomer.
I'm a newcomer, only 30 years. Now, we had a planner to come into the city and talk about our city standards and businesses not going where they want to go but where they will be best suited. Now, everybody is talking about now all of a sudden how bad this 12 mile in Southfield corner is looking. Are you concerned about the fact that for over 20 plus years, Northland and our downtown area has been undeveloped? I think that this project would be better suited at Northland Mall to revitalize our downtown area or possibly the old Home Depot on 8 Mile near J.L. Hudson's or even the vacant building lot across the street. We cannot keep trying to cram all of these businesses because they think it's a good idea, because they give corporate donations, because they give to the community. If you're willing to give to the community, if you are willing to be in Southfield because you're committed and you want to continue to do those things, go to an area where this business would be better suited. And it's a reason why you want to be on 12 in Southfield, because of the perception that people will come and shop with you. If you're concerned about the residents, take it to 8 Mile. Take it to Northland Mall. Revitalize that area and be concerned about getting customers from the south of 8 Mile corridor.
Okay, thank you. Anyone?
Lastly, I brought up the crime issue, and I wasn't concerned about what's in the store. I'm concerned about people leaving the store and traveling in our community. We're already having a few problems with people walking through our backyards, and when they're approached, they say, oh, we're looking for so-and-so. We've also had home invasion, and now we have a problem with rats because of the way that the Kroger disposes of their food, I suppose. I don't know. So, and then you didn't address the issue of the traffic along 12 Mile between Evergreen and Southfield Road.
Mm-hmm.
It's horrendous.
Mm-hmm.
We have two schools there, this little area, two schools, and now you're finding a 24-hour service on one end and a 24-hour service on the other end. Soon, our community is going to be like a North Detroit.
24
hours. We moved here because we wanted a quiet residential area. Now, have you thought about the fact that there's a Walmart about 10 minutes from us and a Myers? They're open all night over on Coolidge and 14 miles. It only takes 10 minutes to get there. And then what are they offering? Groceries? We have so many grocery stores. What about Target?
Mm-hmm.
We don't need that there. But I agree. Northland or maybe Telegraph and Eighth Mile or some other area, but not County residential area.
Okay.
Okay,
thank you.
No, we're just open zone.
My name is Melvin Taylor. I live at 2922 White Cover Step, which is directly behind the Southfield Funeral Home. And the one thing I want to say to the Planning Commission is I applaud you for hearing Walmart. I hope you put it there because within that square area, there is nowhere for any senior citizen to get drugs, food, or anything else without crossing a major street. If children want to go to the store, they can't go without crossing a major street. So it's a safety hazard to have your store so distant that no one can get to. And if you don't have transportation, I'm sorry, you're not going to walk down to Evergreen or to Northland or any place else. There's no store in that square area amongst those busy streets where people can shop. And that area right now is an eyesore, and it's a public safety because there's a lot of blind spots and there's nobody over there. I walk there all the time, and I see people back there. So if you don't develop it, something's going to happen. So I hope you take this positive attitude and a positive idea and place something there for the people in the community. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Kevin. Okay.
Okay. Speaking of whether it's Walmart or not, I live in the directly adjacent to the wall at the northwest corner of the parking lot. Okay. I went through this twice already, meetings. One with a funeral parlor. We were assured there'd be no problems at all with traffic or anything. The next thing was this shopping center also that before there was nothing there when I moved in. We were told it's going to be fine. I have called the police at 2 o'clock in the morning when they come to empty the dumpsters, and the police tell me it's not their job to do that. I have to catch the guy and go stand out there. Now, this is going to revitalize that shopping center like crazy, and there's going to be noise, and there's going to be garbage pickups all night long because they're doing it now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think he addressed the garbage issue during his presentation. There's going to be a compactor.
I'm not talking to their garbage. Okay. I'm talking to garbage at the center that's going to revitalize, mm-hmm. where the restaurant was and all these other empty stores. I mean, if I was a businessman, I'd move into that center without a question. And they pick up garbage now at 2 o'clock in the morning, and the police won't do a thing about it. I had to go out there one night and catch the guy and get his truck number and turn him in to get anything done.
Okay.
Hi, Carrie James, 2804 Marshall Street. In regards to all the traffic and everything, I know Walmart transports people to their stores in different communities. Is that something that you're proposing to do for the Southfield location? And if so, how many transportation vehicles would be coming in and out of there? And how many people would be coming to the store?
What we did on this plan is we actually looked at it with city staff as well, but we actually called the smart bus people up, and we're going to actually be putting in bus access points and shelters, smart shelters for not only on the Southfield Road site, but on also the 12 Mile Road site, and they will have then concrete walkways to the store.
Not exactly what I'm referring to.
Yeah, but Mr. Chairman, if you'd like me to address your question, Walmart does at a number of our locations. We utilize both private providers and our own transportation. There are particularly some senior shelters mm-hmm. in the city of Detroit, and what she's describing is we work with groups that pull up a small bus at the actual senior center in Detroit. The seniors come out of their center, and again, as the gentleman over here described earlier, they don't have any walkable locations in the city of Detroit. So once a week they get on the bus, and then the bus from the senior center drives to one of the store locations, and those individuals then park, go into the store, do their shopping, maybe get their prescription drugs, whatever it might be, get back on the bus and come back. At this point there are no plans to do that, but that doesn't mean that if this store is approved by the Planning Commission, approved by council, that a senior center that I'm not aware of in the community reaches out to the store manager and says it's a wonderful program. We've got 300 seniors in the center that need, would you be interested in that? If that's the case, then then what we do is we make arrangements with them for a drop-off and a pickup time. And that's how the program
works. What usually is the frequency of something like that?
Like I said, I believe most of the groups that we work with, particularly in the city of Detroit, do once a week. But I'm sorry, I just don't know off the top of my head if, like, for example, the Livonia store or the Roseville store, which has that proximity to Detroit, they could be doing one every day from, like, five different senior centers. I just don't know how that operates. But, I mean, we could certainly, if the chairman would like, we can get some answers to that question and provide more specific details if you and commissioners would like that.
My name is Ann Gilmore, and I live on Summer Street. And I've been to several of these meetings, and I certainly think Walmart has put together a very professional presentation. However, Ms. Bassett, I don't believe, lives in the neighborhood, and I think it's important for the commission to understand the people who are showing up here and the people who have the concerns that are coming meeting after meeting are those people who live within a stone's throw, within a quarter mile of the site that's going to be here. And one of the questions that I have is, south of Webster, on the east side of the street, is a shopping mall that used to be a Farmer Jack, and it's gone through several owners. And I'm just wondering why that particular location wasn't being chosen to be revitalized. Because people say this particular site is abandoned. However, no one has brought up the fact that the Sheltering Arms facility is basically going to close down. And I don't know, with their relationship with the Archdiocese of Detroit, if they do feel comfortable showing up at a meeting like this to voice any of their concerns.
Thanks for your comments. Sir?
Oh, I'm sorry. Fred Spencer again. Question for consideration by the commission. I hear a lot of numbers about your traffic projections and also security issues. My question, I'm looking at this location of the store. What I read in the sub area, a part of the master agreement, was that this area was going to be built to serve the general local area, like within, let's say, a 1.5 mile radius. This store, if you look at it where the other stores exist, the corner is going to serve in probably 4 or 5 miles wide and go maybe north 2 miles, so I'm sure south 5 or 6 miles, okay, because there's no stores in that area. And that we talked about where some of those neighborhoods are. The discussion is made about some of these calculations. I mean, is anybody considering that, or what is the real intended zone that this store is supposed to supply? Because I think it's going to bring a lot more people in than maybe somebody's putting on the table in this proposal. That's all. That's where I think we're all concerned about here, is that the traffic is going to go crazy because maybe the numbers weren't calculated correctly.
Okay.
Yes. My name is Marilyn Brooker. I live at 30490 Woodstock. I'm the president of the Pinewood Manor Homeowners Association. We're at 13 miles east of Southfield Road. Our concern, the residents, because we had polled after we had heard about this project, everyone wanted to know, were there other sites that were considered? Because of the traffic currently at 12 miles on Southfield Road, we agree that, you know, we have various sites in the city of Southfield that need to be occupied. However, that particular intersection is already overburdened, and we agree that there need to be traffic signal upgrades or some other type of activity to help control traffic. But right now, when you think about the traffic on Southfield Road from 696 to 13 miles, I mean, it takes us forever. You know, and, you know, you're just at the point, the residents on that far end of the city, you know, say it's easier to go outside of the city of Southfield to handle your business. And I think, you know, we try to encourage our residents to stay within the city of Southfield to support the businesses. You know, but just that traffic congestion has created a major impasse.
Okay, thank you. Okay, I think we're going to wrap this up. Commissioner Bill?
Yes, if I could, I'm not sure who to address it to. Are there any Walmarts in the metropolitan area that are in an urban setting like this?
We have a number of locations with equal population densities, if not greater than this location.
Well, I'm talking about the density that this particular site is, and where are they?
Yeah, we're
okay. I mean, for this site in particular, particularly with the proximity to 696, the brand new Warren location would be, I mean, probably right dead set onto this project. And the reason I say that, Mr. Chairman, is you've got direct proximity to 696, you've got a major thoroughfare in Van Dyke Avenue that carries multiple thousands of vehicles through the course of the day, both from Warren residents and Sterling Heights residents and residents throughout the area. It's also at the intersection of 12 Mile, which we all know is, I've been told, is the alternate route for 696 in these meetings. So I'm assuming if it's the alternate route for 696 in Southfield, that it's similarly the alternate route for 696 in Warren. And it also has the immediate proximity to residential homes that this proposed site would have, in that there are both to the north, unlike this one, which is just one to the immediate west of the location, the Warren store has homes immediately abutting the property to the north and then also to the far east of the same complex. So that's probably close, population density, traffic, et cetera.
And could you tell me what size lot that sets on?
It's a pretty large, it's an old development that was built back in the 60s, I think. That location itself is a, it's kind of one of the older shopping malls that you would have found in most of the metropolitan Detroit urban areas. So it's kind of an L-shaped shopping plaza with a couple of standalone locations right in front. There is a Applebee's restaurant and a
Tim Horton
in the physical property line of it. There is an existing old country buffet in that plaza. There
can you tell me approximately how many acres it is?
It's a pretty large parcel, but it's a pretty unique development in that technically Walmart owns own the entire parcel. We'll be developing the far west side of that property, and then the balance of the complex itself, we're assuming at some point, will be sold to another developer at a later date.
So you can't tell me how large it is.
It's like 27 acres,
230,000 feet of retail with it. Another good example would be Roseville at 12 Mile and Gratiot. It's a site maybe even a little tighter than this in terms of size.
Again, two pretty major.
There's numerous locations around there.
Could you give me, you said it's probably tighter than this. Could you give me some figures that I can visualize?
We can certainly work that up. It's a shopping center. It's an existing shopping center. There are other retailers in that shopping center. So
the Walmart parcel size, I think, is maybe 9 acres,
but it's integrated with the shopping center.
And what is the square
footage? And I need to verify this, but I'm pretty sure it's...
And what is the square footage of the Walmart?
The Walmart right now is being is going through an expansion. It's been approved for expansion. Robert, what's the size of it? 155,000 feet? 156?
Yeah.
So it's a little bit larger than what we're proposing here. Maybe on a little bit less land area, but it's integrated with a shopping center.
Troy, Dearborn, the proposed Lincoln Park site, they're all very similar in population.
And we will get those numbers next week. I mean, we can have the exact square footage, the exact acreage, so we're talking specifics. Just like we did this week, we'll have a follow-up slide on questions that were asked tonight and follow-up, very much like we did this week.
I'm just trying to visualize an existing facility that is this size whatever size and how it functions because I'm having difficulty with this size of facility functioning well on this piece of property. There's going to have to be a parking waiver granted in order to meet the parking requirements. the ordinance, and one of the shared parking entities, the funeral home, the way our parking requirements are written in the ordinance, only requires 47 spaces, when that is an absurdity as far as what he actually needs, as you can tell by what he's expanding to. And so that's one of my biggest concerns, is that you don't meet the zoning ordinance in parking.
If I could ask that you keep an open mind, obviously in terms of this comment, a 91 space parking waiver was granted for the smaller portion of the shopping center. We would be requesting a 74 space parking waiver for the entire three entities: the funeral home, the Walmart, and the remaining shopping center. There was a 91 space waiver that was granted just for this small shopping center. So we're just going to be requesting a 74 space parking waiver. And as far as the city's code for the Walmart, obviously it's a much higher parking standard than what Walmart requires. Walmart looks at around 4 spaces per 1,000 square feet, and I think the city's code looks at about 6.66. So it's much higher. So keep that in mind as well. But again, we would be requesting a 74 space parking waiver.
Mr. Chair, just to respond to that comment, we did talk about there is a possibility if they remove interior landscaping and the car corrals and stuff, they could get more parking.
That's correct.
I wouldn't recommend that, because I think our parking standards are excessive. The standard is 1 to 4, 1 to every 250 feet, or 4 to 1,000. Ours is in the 6 to 1,000 range. And I'd rather have the trade-off of additional landscaping and better circulation on Sunday. So Walmart is able to get closer to what is required on paper. And that all has to be considered by the Zoning Board of Appeals. But in this particular case, I think we know our standards are overparked in many cases. I'd rather have the landscaping and get close to what the standards are and make sure that works, more importantly, than just meet the exact requirement on the paper. And that's for a further discussion. And again, I want to remind the audience that 2 weeks from tonight is our official public hearing. We'll be at the City Council Chambers, and that's the opportunity you will have an opportunity to actually make your official comments. Today was a study session, and we did want to open up some comments so that we can address those before our next meeting. I know Robert referenced next week, but we're actually meeting 2 weeks from tonight.
What is the date of that meeting?
The 28th of November. It'll be at 6:30, and it'll be in the city hall proper in the large council chambers, and residents will be given up to 5 minutes to make their comments at the public hearing. After the public hearing, and if the Planning Commission makes a recommendation, there'll be further opportunity for you come to public meetings that the City Council will be holding over the course of the next couple months. So this is not the final, final opportunity to make comments. And the Commission is a recommending body, and you will have an opportunity to make official comments. We also will accept any written comments, and we'll make sure that they're part of the record if you don't feel comfortable speaking in public. And you can do it both ways. You can direct your comments through the planning department, and we'll make sure they're made part of the record, and that will move forward with attaching to the city council. And if I could, through the chair, I'm going to recommend that we take a 5-minute recess and reconvene in the council study room for our last item. And I will be doing a PowerPoint presentation on the overlay development district that we'll be considering over the next couple months. Public is welcome to join us, but we're only going to be dealing with the overlay district, and we're only going to be taking about 15 minutes as an introduction. But we'll be discussing that in detail in your December meeting.
Okay.
One question.
Are the minutes available online or something of this meeting?
And through the chair, just a really, really quick question. I don't normally agree with Commissioner Bell, but I think he's on target about that light. Because I've read your traffic study, and you guys said in the traffic study you made a big deal about putting a new traffic light there. And if you're only going to put a new pole, then decorative pole there, and it's the same system now, it's not alleviating the problem. Why do you think that would resolve the issue?
It's not just a mistake. It's a controller, it's an overlap, it's phasing, it's new everything.
or they give them two days a week where he can work from home. And many times he goes to the library or Starbucks. That's his office. So they're not paying for overhead. Retailers, generally the trend is that their size is shrinking because online shopping is going up. But people still want to see the product, touch it, feel it, sit in it. And so the retailers are moving more to showrooms with online. And we have to be flexible and try to stay ahead of some of these changes. Climate adaptation. We can stand here all night and argue the reasons for climate change, whether it's man-made or it's just a cycle. But statistically, our climate is changing. And what happened with Superstorm Sandy, I was at the APA National Conference in Boston a year and a half ago, and the planners from New York showed a scary scenario of exactly what happened. They were showing major rain events where the water was going down into the subways and into the tunnels. They knew that the sea level was rising, and they said that Manhattan, God help them, they were hoping they had 10, 20, 30 years to deal with it. This scenario that I saw was almost a forecast of what happened 2 weeks ago in Sandy. And it's going to have dramatic effects even in our community, in our climate, because we're going to have more extreme weather conditions. We're going to have more freeze thaw, which is going to affect our roadway systems. Low impact design is going to be important to try to mitigate some of the stormwater. We've already seen our landscape climate zone change by one complete zone to the warmer side. So these are all things as planners and commissioners that we have to keep in mind. Sustainability is kind of one of the hot buzzwords nowadays, and it's not just about environmental sustainability, it's about social and economic sustainability. Placemaking and creating a sense of place is important. Even the top guys now at MSHTA, the Michigan State Housing Authority, they're using these terms. They know that affordable housing and putting money into a specific project is no good if you don't address the bigger picture, the neighborhood and the community. And I was recently up at the state conference in Traverse City. Their downtown has less than a 2% vacancy rate for retail, and yet they have no parking requirements in their downtown district. They either as a public entity, they provide public parking, or the developers provide underground parking or on-site parking based on their own needs. But there's no standards. And you say, how could they have less than 2% vacancy and have such density and not require any parking? Because they think outside the box and they deal with it in different ways. And I only use that as an example about having stringent standards. One size fits all doesn't work all the time. And I showed this to the council. What are we talking about? What does this all look like? And to create this kind of density with mixed-use development, with retail on the first floor and office, residential above, hotel complex, shared parking, parking garages, walkable community, we need to adapt. Our regional center does allow some mixed use, but has a lot of limitations. You can have retail, but no more than 10% of the floor area, and it has to serve the building of the people that are located. We still have these exorbitant parking standards and requirements that require developers to build a sea of asphalt around our building. And especially in areas of higher density like BDA and the city center, we want to be more flexible. We don't want these rigid 50-foot setbacks from the front yard. We want to encourage this type of on-street development with parking and shared parking and parking garages and walkability. And again, you know, what does this look like at the ground level? It shows diversity, it shows walkability, it shows biking, low-impact design, LED lighting, bioswales, bike parking, mixed-use retail, and a place that people want to be, want to shop, want to live, go to school, and want to work. And these are, again, just examples of what vision could create if we had the tools in place. So the Overlay Development District is a set of regulations. It includes a definition section, a purpose intended qualifications, uses permitted and uses prohibited, rezoning procedure, and site plan approval and construction. The purpose is to encourage development and redevelopment, to provide flexibility, to foster creativity, and preserve desirable features such as natural, historic, and architectural. It modifies traditional form of zoning. It permits variety in design, and things like setback, layout, parking, uses, and signage are treated on a case-by-case basis. So if under conventional zoning you're required to have 250 parking spaces, but you know you have a parking garage within walking distance, and you want to create greater flexibility, you allow the density, reduce the parking, reduce the setbacks for high-quality design and for more mixed use. That's the trade-off. And each case is negotiated between the developer and the city. It encourages efficiency of use of land, so you can get more built on the parcels than our traditional suburban model. And it also ensures compatibility with surrounding land uses. In return for greater flexibility, we expect exceptional quality design, above average pedestrian amenities, creative design and layout of buildings, focus on pedestrian space and circulation, significant architectural features, compatibility with land uses, and provide greater efficiency of the site overall. The intent is to encourage innovation of land uses and a variety of design, to promote low-impact design, permit flexibility in the placement of setbacks, parking lot area, etc., again, to encourage pedestrian amenities, to improve the public infrastructure, promote more sustainable and a healthy community because it's going to promote walking, achieve coordinated site design. We don't have design guidelines for architecture, but this gives us the flexibility to require higher standards on our architecture and ultimately to encourage redevelopment. What I'm proposing, there's a standard set of lists where we looked at each of these districts and looked at what the underlying zoning currently permits. We've scaled that back to desirable uses, and what I'm going to propose we work through is developing a table and a chart that says certain uses would be permitted in the Telegraph Road corridor because that's more encouraged for high-tech research. That would be different than the city center, and the city center and the DDA would probably be more similar, but there might be certain uses that we want to either encourage or discourage in each of those districts. We might not want to encourage gas stations in our city center district, and therefore we would prohibit them even if they're currently allowed in a B3 district. Or we say you can have the gas station, but we're not going to give you the flexibility of all these other tools if you want to be developed under conventional zoning. And those are some of the things that we need to work out as a commission before we recommend back to city council. So the rezoning procedure is the same. An application would come in, preliminary review by the planning department. Planning Commission would have their study sessions, hold their public hearing, and make a recommendation to City Council. Then the City Council would either approve the rezoning or deny it. But if they approve it, there'll be a set of standards that they approve that are specific to that site only. And it's similar to a consent judgment in the sense that there's some give and take. Unlike conditional zoning, which is more of a one-way zoning where the developer says this is what I'm willing to do, either take it or leave it, this is a true negotiated document that gets laid out in part and parcel to the rezoning. So instead of rezoning just a B3, which allows all these uses, we are saying we're going to rezone overlay development district for this specific use or uses with these specific conditions on the site. And that document gets recorded and is part and parcel to that approval. And then the applicant has the comfort, the developer has the comfort of saying, now I know what the standards are. I know I will get approved if I meet these standards, and it cuts down the timeline of the final review. So that's really the beauty of it. There's a master development agreement, as I talked about, that both legal, planning, and the developer negotiate and develop the draft with input from the commission that ultimately gets approved by the city council. There's a procedures for major and minor modifications, and that there's performance guarantees that we can attach to this development agreement. Construction has to begin within 18 months after receiving final engineering approval, and multi-phase developments have to start within 24 months of that final engineering approval. Otherwise, it reverts back to the original zoning that it has. So it says, we're not going to give you this approval forever. If you don't start and meet our guidelines, if you're not serious about development, if you don't have your money in place, you will lose this approval. So it encourages that developer to go through this process and be willing to put shovel in the ground in a short frame. And I put this slide in here just to kind of pose the question to the city council that when our city was developed 55 years ago, for whatever reason, they decided that our motto was going to be City of Progress. And it has served us well for a long time. We wouldn't have those tall buildings over there. We wouldn't have some of the unique things that make Southfield unique compared to other communities if we didn't think in the future, if we weren't forward thinking. And I think lately we've been thinking too much in the past. And as I said in the beginning part of my presentation, we need to be thinking in the future because the future is changing so quickly. We need to be one step ahead of everyone so that we can be competitive with our other communities who are still in the 70s and the 80s. A lot of communities fought more than two-story buildings. They wanted to keep it low level. And again, we were progressive because we allowed these tall buildings to be built in our community. We said that we wanted that density and we wanted to be competitive in the workforce. I'm saying now we need to look at these other tools to make us competitive in these, you know, tough economic times.
I just was thinking about that and was wondering about what happens when, let's say, one of these developers gets these waivers or special grants on site plan approval and things, and what happens to the next, or, you know, let's say maybe they go out of business or something. Do all those grants get transferred to the next developer of that property?
If the sequence and the timing meets within our thresholds, then it would carry on. But if the council doesn't grant an extension, then it reverts back. And so then the new developer would almost have to start from scratch. And that's the protection, that if you're unable to carry this through, if you can't build it the way it is, and it doesn't get built in a reasonable time period, it reverts back.
Yeah, so let's say they build it, they're there for 10 years, and then, you know, somebody else wants, you know, for some reason they're done, somebody else wants to build it, take over that property.
Well, it would be no different than...
All of those still transfer.
Well, yeah, because the site is an existing conforming site. If they were to redevelop the site, then they'd have to meet the standards,
right,
or they'd have to come back and go through the process. I think the scenario might be if, let's say, it's a phase project, and they build phase one, and they just don't have the money, and there's a long delay before phase two took place, the city council could revert it back to the original zoning, and they would either have to conform to conventional zoning or they have to go through the process again. Now, if a new developer came in to build phase two, and it was in the 24-month period, then those standards would still be good for them to move forward.
I can understand the developer's perspective on it and how they want to be ensured that, okay, I spent, let's say, almost $1 million in all this research, time, and development for this big project to go through. And then, yeah, at the end of the day, there's no guarantee. So, I mean, that's kind of what they want. That's kind of what we're giving them, right?
That's plus flexibility.
Yeah.
Okay? So they don't have to worry necessarily about going to at the end of the process, going to get 15 waivers from the ZBA.
Right.
Or they don't have to worry about other things that don't work. Or being short on... Well, the biggest thing for me is the flexibility of mixed uses. Because right now they're hampered by, I only can do 10% of retail, and because the rest of this, the market doesn't support 90% housing and 10% retail, you know, and that's what our current ordinances are limiting. We got the development down the street too, where you got small parcels for redevelopment. You know, Jeff will tell me you put a 50-foot setback around the whole building, your building's only going to be 5,000 square feet. This doesn't make sense, especially when we want to encourage. we can't build a second story and mix the uses, because this use is allowed in B1, and this use is allowed in OS, and this use is allowed in RC, and RC you have to have a 10-acre minimum. We're discouraging small development and redevelopment on our parcels, especially in these districts. And we're only talking about in these districts because they have special unique characteristics. They're more walkable, they're higher density, there's more office workers, and so forth.
Would be any provision in there when they have their timeline, 18 months or 24, if they give probable cause or whatever, that this happened, that happened, can we get an extension? Will that be something?
We look at if there's a legitimate attempt to move the project along, and for whatever reason they dig and they find an Indian burial ground, which causes them, you know, mm-hmm. 9 months of delay mm-hmm. or something, that's within reason. But if they just start pushing dirt around just to stay in the timeline and no intended building, then the city council could revoke that. Mm-hmm. They can start the procedure for revoking that, right?
Okay. I think the idea, too, is, first of all, this is awesome, and it's exactly what I want to see, especially right here in the city center district. But the idea is, once this gets going, it's going to make sense. Like, why do you want to go to this area? Because it's busy. There's people there with money. There's already this built. I want to be next to them. Then went on there. Now this person wants to come in. Now everyone wants to live there.
Oh, it's attractive.
Then it's cool. Then it makes money.
It's a magnet.
Right. And I point across the street. You know, why is that site staying vacant for so long? Well, when you get developers coming in, they're limited in what they can build there and how it's got to be built. Especially in a tough economic times, it just makes it even less likely that someone's going to take a chance and build anything there.
Waste a dollar.
You know, just looking at a small scenario, you know, retail is going at $24, $26 a square foot, but the second story for office is around $16 a square foot. For housing, it might be even less. When you start putting a second story on there, you got to put an elevator on, space for common space. It's not economically viable for somebody to take that leap and just build a two-story building. Then you start adding more stories on it, it starts recovering the cost. If you can have a larger footprint, that ground space lease helps pay for the other improvements on the site. And then if you don't have to pave the whole thing in parking and able to pick up so many people walking there, then it gives you more square footage to get more rent to help. You know, it's a cyclic thing.
Yes. No, I was just going to say, I echo Jeremy's sentiment about it's about time that we saw something like this as well, because my intent when I moved to Southfield was the location is convenient for the outlying areas, your Royal Oaks, your Novi's, your Detroit's, whatever. But if you're moving here, you're still traveling outside the boundaries of the city. So for a person like me who wants to live and work and do things in my community, something like this will help, like you said, grow that notion, will help provide the businesses, will help keep people here versus people always traveling out. Because the guy in the Walmart thing made a good point, which is senior citizens or people who don't have transportation, your community should be someplace that you want to be able to walk in, and the businesses should be there. So I think this is something that's very important, especially, like you said, in those areas. And this vacant land that we have here, why aren't we thriving in Royal Oak or Novi or Ferndale or whatever? We have the space. Why not use it appropriately? So I agree.
I don't want to go twice before once, but when I used to do a lot of conceptual design when people used to build buildings in Michigan, you know, that was always the first thing. Go talk to the city and the planner and say, here's what we're thinking, get a warm, fuzzy feeling, move forward or not. And I think there's a little disconnect. Like, I think a lot of us here give that warm, fuzzy feeling, and then it hits the next level, and you get vetoed and denied. So having the rules with flexibility is great, and then say, we did what we said we're going to do, so give us the approval and move forward. That's going to be huge. It's very important, because you spend a lot of money on design fees, and I'm happy to take that money from people, and I'd like to get more money from people doing designs for them, but people aren't willing to spend money just kind of chasing things that aren't realistic or
or whatever. So I think it's going to be great to have the flexibility, obviously, but once you do something innovative, be rewarded for it, move on. You know, get things built, and once things are built, again, like I said, just build and snowballs in a positive way.
No, and I hate to go back to Golden Corral, but we've heard that they've got $100,000, whether it's on purchase options, design fees, flying people in, $100,000. And that doesn't mean we should approve anything just because people spend money. We shouldn't put slaughterhouses next to residential. But, I mean, think about that kind of investment in those seats and then come away with, you know, a denial.
6-1 denial.
And can you imagine, again, what Walmart's spending? They're flying those guys in from Arkansas and, you know, there's 10 staff there in the six-figure...
See, that's what the developer said, you know, the vision. I'm glad we picked it up. If they had known, had something, if we'd had something in place like this, it would have, not saying that they would approve the Golden Corral, but if we'd had a process in place, a checklist, and this is exactly to me what this is. It's a checklist, saying, okay, I've done all these things, now I don't have to go through the stuff being up there, took a 5.5 hours to get a no vote. This is devastating. Okay, but I agree, you know, being engineers you are, being from manufacturing, when you've got a list and you make that check off and at the bottom line, you met all those requirements, what else can you ask for? You have, but frankly, we have nothing. All we have is you might say yes, he might say no, and I might say yes. But if you've got a checklist and I've hit all those boundaries, hit all the marks, I don't know how you can tell me no. And this is a vision that, that we need to start using those tools
I just can't understand how we can continue to let, you know, 6-7 residents stop projects. You know, I'm not sure how we can get around it or what can be done, how we can handle things differently, approach things differently. But we can never grow if we continue to let, you know, a handful of vocal residents stop projects. I mean, they don't have the same, you know, information that we have here. And that you have, but it's going to be difficult, I think, to really get any major projects done.
One of the things I did want to share with you, and all we can do is try to encourage education and public participation.
So we sent out 365 notices the first round, and then we sent out an additional 246 notices. So we sent out 611. Notices to people in adjacent properties, not including subdivision like associations, who then broadcast out to others. So the law says 300 feet. We normally do 350 feet. We went 700 feet to try to make sure that we get the comments from the residents so that we can make informed recommendations and the council can make informed decisions. So I mean, we're going above and beyond. It is a big project, but that's why we've put in this extra effort. And these guys are spending hours getting labels and tracking addresses and stuffing envelopes and making sure that stuff gets out. And, you know, Walmart had 4 neighborhood meetings on their own before we even had our meetings. And, you know, that's the only thing that we can do. We're never going to have everybody completely agreeing. There's going to be always those naysayers. But I saw a pretty balanced 2 public meetings with, you know, people, some in favor, some against, some nodding their head, somebody, you know, being at least satisfied that we're addressing all of their concerns. And that's the bottom line. That will help. And that process didn't happen so much with Golden Corral. So we're trying to learn. We're trying to learn. The developer's trying to learn. Hopefully the city learns through that process.
The ones that really speak up are the ones that's usually against it. The ones that don't want it, those are the ones that show up to all the meetings and all the vocals. People that really want the project and think it's a good idea, I think they think it's automatically going to happen because it's such a great idea and it's so good. They don't really participate. They just think it's just going to happen. Doesn't seem to be a great idea. But I would like to see, hopefully, more people that's really for projects that will start showing up and being more vocal. Process move on a lot faster, because I know city council, they get a bunch of people in there complaining and whining and totally against it. That's how they're going to vote.
if we have more things like this already on the books, looking at certain sites and what can possibly be done to them, this type of thing, like they keep talking about Northland. The biggest thing I hear people saying, and I won't quote my girlfriend's name, that don't want the, they're afraid of Detroit coming in and this turning into that. They're afraid of crime, what looks at crime. I'm looking at it, the Kmart. Say what it is.
Walmart.
I think about all the different markets that closed in Southfield that I would go to the one just north of 9 Mile. There was a Farmer Jack's there. There was a Farmer Jack's over on Lasser Road and what's that? 11 Mile. Now, I saw a lot of them close. The Kroger's deadened. We did get a Myers. No one wants it in their neighborhood. But all the stuff they're talking about doing, I got these mixed feelings because I'm trying to be the resident. I'm trying to think of the city. I'm thinking about the tax base that may help us keep our police, that type of thing. So we got to grow some kind of way, but if we have something on the book and we take different pieces and look at what can be done and get approval for that kind of thing, now you don't have all the junk that happens that the neighborhoods are involved in this too, so that they had a hand in it, so that now when it's bringing forth, you don't lose a Golden Corral. That was a big, big money base. But I understand the people that were in the area. They come out. They have to come out. It's in their neighborhood. It's in their backyard. And if the people don't handle the stuff right, they will have rats. So I understand the concerns. And
but that's why we have
a
codes department.
That's
right.
The
building department.
And that's why we ask the question, how are you handling that?
And, you know, I hate to refer to the incident that happened this Sunday, but sometimes there's random acts.
At the police station?
At the police station.
Yeah.
I mean, who would have thought that someone would come in
to
the police station with a gun, okay? Things do happen.
Right.
And it's unfortunate, and thank God it wasn't a busy day, and they dealt with it, and it's unfortunate the poor soul that got killed. Those things do happen, and they can happen at stores, and they can happen anywhere. That doesn't mean that it's an unsafe city and it's a bad city, and I'd never go to the police department again. But it's just...
But you have to do your checks and balances, like they're talking about the security lights. I'm glad they have that many security lights. And they need to state that, and that needs to be in the newspaper. So, so they'll know, ooh, we don't want to commit any crime over there. They know what you got.
They know what they're doing.
Huh?
I just want the top retailers in the world. They know what they're doing.
But I want to know what ideas this board has, not board, commission has, for Northland. What can we...
Northland,
I'm just throwing that out there. Let me just say this real quick.
I know it's late.
Yeah.
But the Overlay Development District also will be for Northland and the DDA.
Good.
The other thing is, and you hear it, and I hear it from the audience, why did you bring these guys in here? We didn't. It's a free market.
Right.
And we don't control and own the land. Archdiocese of Detroit decided to sell the land, or at least a purchase option, to Walmart. They did. It had nothing to do with the city. We didn't go out and recruit them and say, go to our...
You can't do
that. The other thing that ties our hands with Northland is it's privately owned, and it's owned by a conglomerate out of New York City. They have like a $32 million bank loan, and the property is appraised at $12 to $14 million. So they're upside down on their mortgage. They need to spend $1 million, $2 million in rehabbing it to attract new tenants. The bank says, pay off your mortgage, and we'll give you the $1.5 million loan. Then you have parcels, because it was developed before the city even existed, you have separate parcels that are islands among themselves. Jeff and I deal with the old Montgomery Ward's building. That lot, that ownership, is literally about 5 feet outside the building. They don't have any parking. They have no right to even get to their building unless someone gives them permission.
Montgomery Ward.
On Greenfield.
Greenfield.
Then the mothball former JCPenney store, they own and retain it because they don't want any competitor going in there within their 10-mile radius. And guess what? They own the air rights to anything out in the parking lot, so they won't allow any out parcel development.
Oh.
And people say to us, why don't you just get it redeveloped? How come you're not just redeveloping it? They also have their own utility system. It's a steam-powered generator in the basement. They have their own electrical supply. And it's 60 years old, and it needs major rehab. Macy's needs about 100,000 square feet. They're in a 400,000 square foot building. They mothball the top three floors. So there's so many challenges. I can't even tell you half of the issues that are going on there. And it's just like, how come you planners, why don't you just redevelop that? Why don't you just have Walmart? Well, Walmart also looked, I can tell you, they looked on 8 Mile down by the old, was it Home Depot or what was that site there?
Home Depot.
The parcel's too small. Then we started looking at, well, what if we assembled? We had to close the street. We had to buy 3-4 parcels. They have to combine them. It's not deep enough. And then they said, even if this all worked, we still want to be on 12 Mile Southfield because it's a different market. So they say, we'd love to build two stores in Southfield. We'd love to build one on 8 Mile, and we'd love to build one at 12 in Southfield. One doesn't mean that they would build a... So believe me, we've gone through all this.
Thanks for that information.
why don't they pursue the waiver for parking? I mean, if they had the waiver for parking, they'd need their parking requirement.
The 91 places?
Yeah.
That seems to be... I don't see how you can when that waiver was tied to a complete shopping center where now half of it has been removed from the equation.
And like I said, they technically, they can meet the parking requirements. If they removed every island, and they took every car corral, and all you would have is just a parking lot.
Yeah.
And they more than exceed the landscaping, so it's not like we'd say, well, you're short on landscaping.
Yeah, there'll be a ton of extra parking there anyways. I was just wondering why, it's just going to tie to that other property.
Do they have enough green space to so-called land bank? Let's say they have enough.
I mean, in theory, that could be a recommendation, is that we say, we want you to put 100 spaces in green space for future parking, and if you need it, build it. That's one thing. The other thing I would say is we should consider, as a commission, if you make your recommendation, maybe consider saying we recommend a non-24-hour Walmart.
That was another thing.
I mean, that's something you can just say, you know what, Walmart? We're happy to have you open for business from 6 a.m. to 2 a.m., but from 2 a.m. to 6 a.m., we recommend that you stay closed.
Mm-hmm.
I think that might go a long way.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. What about that entrance on that street from where the funeral home? Are they able to at night to close that off so that they won't worry about people coming in the evening going out that way if the funeral home is closed? Why do they have to have that?
We could talk to the funeral
the other.
Maybe gating that.
Mm-hmm. You know, gate it to where when you need it, open it, and when it's closed,
If you're not open past 9 or 10 p.m., that could be gated.
You would have to put a fence the entire length of that that shared property line. You can't just gate where the sidewalk
is.
You'd basically have to gate off the entire
area
by
Guy Street. That's what I'm talking about.
Yeah, Guy Street.
We could require them to put a gate up and close it off at 10 o'clock at night.
But I'm thinking in the neighborhood will feel more secure if people aren't just driving through there, roaming around.
That's a good. But then how are they going to get in? Because you got some that want to get in. Neighbors. I'm just throwing it out. I don't want you to force me in.
The Edwards scenario where the council turned into one way, and we know there's 23 people every day going one way. It's human nature. Some people are going to figure a way to get around it, but it's not going to be the majority of them. I don't want to keep you any longer.
We had a little
We should have a bar across the road. There's some apartments above it and an office next to it. And we'd walk there.
And then he would take us all over there.
Hey, Roy has something.
Yes,
back to this presentation. Could we get a copy of your presentation?
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, the presentation.
Mm-hmm.
That's
right, ladies and gentlemen.
That's right,
I know that. You like stuff like that.
Building in my front yard.
Yeah, I know you
do.
Are we meeting next week?
No.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Have a good Thanksgiving.
Same to you.